than you think. It's not a tournament. It's what you don't see on TV. The cash is real. The stakes are high. They bet big. They win big. They lose big. High stakes live action poker. Live at the bike. Watch it live on the web. Or play it if you dare. At the Bicycle Casino right here in Los Angeles.
Hello, everyone, and welcome to another week of Live at the Bike, brought to you by the Bicycle Casino in Los Angeles, California, the first and only webcast of real action cash game poker. My name is Bart Hansen. I'm here with Dave Tuckman, fresh back from a little kind of a reunion of friends in Vegas over the weekend. How are you feeling right now? I know you did the drive back and forth, kind of beat.
I'm a little beat.
You're a little beat.
But always ready for poker.
Oh, all right. Well, tonight's going to be a $200 no-limit game. The blinds for this game are 3 and 5. Essentially, it was a little bit slow out on the floor. We're trying to get a 300 to 500 no-limit game down tonight because tomorrow we're doing a special event. Normally, we do that game tomorrow, but we're not going to be doing that game.
Right.
But anyways, we got this. It's the next best, and this game's been going for days and days straight, and I can see that a couple guys have over $1,000
on the
table.
I mean, this is going to play like a 3 to 5 game.
Yeah, it doesn't really matter. Yeah. Let's head over here to the table, and let's get it a game here.
You know, we got an interesting hand here. He's got ace-king in seat number one. And ace-queen in seat number six.
And we'll introduce the players after this hand. So, we couldn't really see what the, I assume... And look at the ace... that's Reggie who folds there with 7-10. Now, is that Kachik? Kachik.
Yeah, and he's in really bad shape, obviously. He's going to need running queens or running hearts.
He's going to raise here, Dave. He's going to min-raise, and you know what? With his stack, I don't think there's any play. I think ace-king can just pretty much push... There's a couple spades out there. You don't ever want to get somebody with a weak ace to lay it down because a spade comes here on the turn,
exactly.
Right?
No.
But he's going to, as always, a lot of people at this level, he's going to call.
I mean, he did bet right into it.
He's going to call. I don't know why you wouldn't go over the top. Turn's 10.
Well, you could be behind the pocket eights, right?
Yeah, I guess. And I'm going to lay that down for 200 more. And now he check calls, and now he bets. Well, maybe he just figured, you know what? I'm going to see if a spade doesn't come. This guy moves in, and it's going to be a call.
Kind of a check call, stop and go type play.
Yep.
And John's going to win this one.
Well, he could catch a jack, that other guy, for straight, but it doesn't come.
I knew it wasn't coming.
Yeah.
Okay, let's introduce the players. Seat number one, we've got John. John just won a nice pot with ace-king there. Seat number two is Reggie. And Reggie plays this game often. Pretty good player. Seat number three, we've got Brian. And have you played with Brian before?
I don't think so.
No? Okay. So he plays tonight. Seat number four, we've got Al. And that is not Philly Al, it's a different Al.
Although I did see Philly Al in the casino today, funny enough.
And we've seen Al on the show before.
Okay.
Seat number five, we've got Calvin. And Calvin has got a ridiculous amount of chips in front of him.
Yeah, for this
he's got $1,800 in front of him.
Wow.
I mean, that is just insane. Seat number six, we've got Kachik, who just lost the ace-queen. And sometimes in this game, it's just really tough to get away from that hand, because by the time you find that you're behind, you feel you're almost pot committed. Seat number seven, we've got, and that's Jamie. And Jamie's a new player to the game here. Got about $200 in front of him. Seat number eight, we've got Alan. And Alan, we've seen him on the show before. Always interested in the game. And seat number nine is Nathan.
And the Yankees hat.
Yeah, and Nathan is, he can be somewhat of an aggressive player. I'll be interested to see him in this game.
You know, it's funny you keep saying that, but aren't most of these guys new? I gotta be honest with you, I haven't seen any of those guys play.
None of them?
No.
You've never seen seat number nine play?
No.
You've never played with him?
The only ones we get word that have played him live of the bike.
No, I know, but you've never played with number nine?
No.
Really?
No.
Wow. And if I go on, then I'm not going to say... Seat number nine plays a lot of tournaments.
Okay.
Somewhat aggressive.
Well, we had a raise here pre-flop. And I couldn't quite tell who it was from. But we can see what's out there. Queen, 10, queen. Well, Al's got trip queens here in seat four. You know, I want to go maybe so far as to say that maybe Al brought that one in for a raise. I couldn't tell. Reggie's going to come out and bet here with pocket fours. I don't think that Al is going to give him the same respect that JR did on Friday.
to me.
To you, right.
Yeah,
although
probably.
I didn't flop
he didn't
much.
Trips. Same difference, though, right? Almost?
Almost. Reggie Betts with deuces. Seat four is going to call, just call with trip queens here. How cagey, Dave. And seat six is all in here with ace deuces.
Well, there's a four. Look at that.
Oh, man, the guy fills up with bottom fulls, you know. Queen 10, queen 4. And we're not going to do cards. At least it looks like he's going to keep betting, at least.
Yeah. Now, seat number two was bluffing with pocket fours and then got there on the turn. The board was queen, 10, queen. And seat number two, of course, has a queen.
Yeah.
And there it is.
And there it is. And he needs a seven here or the board to pair. And the river's a nine. And the guy with pocket fours, is Reggie there, is going to basically bust two guys there.
Yeah. Now, seat number six is all in there with the ace deuce. Makes nothing.
And somebody asked to see the guy's hand.
Yeah.
And, you know, obviously, you know, at this level, I'm sure the players aren't necessarily keen to the fact that for some reason, if you're in there with queen seven and you get heat on a board of queen, ten, queen, there's a really good chance that your hand might not be good. Now, that guy's just backed into the best hand, but he fired once, he fired twice. I'm sure if they were deeper, he was going to commit all his chips. At some point, you probably might come to the deduction that queen seven is no good.
Well, you've got to realize, obviously, if somebody's betting into you really strong, is he really going to be betting that strong with, say, a 10 on a board like that?
Right.
You know, he's obviously, people aren't born yesterday. They're going to obviously be aware of the fact that somebody might have a queen.
Right.
Well, ace king now for seat number, actually, wow, two ace kings out there now.
Seat three and seat four.
Yep.
Seat three is the big blind. Actually, C3 is the small one. 100. And looks like it's limped around here. Yep, ace king is just limped in here under the gun. No, excuse me.
No, they're in the
blinds. In the big blind. Yeah.
He's got no chips, so he might just verbally say how much he raised. Well, seat number three is going to raise with the ace king.
Yep. He's going to make it 20 more. Now, Al, I assume he can buy for 300, Dave, when you go down the felt in this game. And it's 20, 25 more or so here. And I think that Al mini-raised to 50. Can I get confirmation of that?
Well, we'll find out really quick and see what seat number three does. No, it is 50 now. You're right.
So a raise out of the small blind and a re-raise here by Al to 50. And, again, we don't know how much seat four is bought in for. Ryan calls. Oh, he's only 100 behind, Dave. He's already put in 50% of his stack. Maybe Brian didn't realize it. I assume that Brian probably would have moved him in, right? With $50 left.
You think so.
And now you wonder if he can actually scare himself. Well, now both players hit top pair.
I was going to say, I mean.
Yeah. And Brian is going to bet. You know, the funny thing about these, sometimes I talk about this in a restricted buying game, I probably check call there with ace king when the guy has 50 left.
Because you know he's going to pot commit himself, even if he's got jacks there.
Well, I give him a chance to let off the hook.
Exactly.
And this one's going to get chopped up. Chop it up there between the two ace kings.
Yeah, it was kind of funny, actually. I was having a lot of fun. I was playing a little 4-8 limit hold'em with my buddies just for an hour or so. They, of course, all wanted to play poker. I, of course, did not want to play poker.
Right.
But I relented and played with them. But I gave one of my good friends a couple of really bad beats, and then after I gave him a bad beat, I asked to see the losing hand.
Of course. Classic. Now, did you get to play that WPT game, obviously?
I was telling you about that. I played that the WPT all-in game. And
the funny thing you were telling me, too, before the show was that, you know, not only does that game not really have a big edge for the house if you play it correctly, but the dealers don't really have a clue as to what's going on. They let you see each other's cards, which is a huge advantage.
Of course.
And they don't know how to play poker themselves. So the game goes really slow, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, you can see your two cards, obviously.
Right.
Plus, if you're playing with three people, you can see eight cards out of the deck.
Yeah.
Really gives you a lot of information.
Limped around here. Limped in here by the button in the big blind. Queen 6-7 with a couple clubs.
Yeah, Calvin's got a gut shot.
Check, check. Turns a king.
Reggie's still in the lead, but hard for him to know that.
How about your hand here for deuces? Deuces are good. One pair.
Yeah.
One pair of deuces. It's good. And there you go.
Take it down, Reggie.
I was telling you, too, I actually played a double shootout on PokerStars last night to try to win my entry into the World Series of Poker. People know about double shootouts. They're one table satellite tournament.
What is it, $150? $160. Okay.
81 entries for a $12,500 package. I won my first table, and I finished in second at the final table. So I got my money back.
Now, if you win your first table,
win, get their money back.
And there's nothing, no difference between second place and ninth place at the final table?
Yeah, pretty much. I think ninth place doesn't get anything, or you get $30, and second through eight get their money back.
Okay. I mean, second place should get more than eighth place, though.
Well, that's not how, I mean, that's not really
not
how you do it, though, in a super satellite,
I guess,
right?
Yeah.
If you're giving out one seat.
Right.
What are you going to do? Get a raise here by seat number one. 20. Pocket fives.
Two pocket fives there. I'm not sure, but I'm going to bet against the five coming in the flop.
Yeah, it's a pretty good bet.
Now, this is one of those whoever bets is probably going to take it down. Power position. Look at seat number one. In position is going to bet it. I remember where I played with John, Nathan now. I played 20-40 hold'em with him.
Did you?
Quite a while ago. And he was ultra-aggressive.
Was he, really?
Super aggressive.
You know, it's funny how, you know, of course, we like to keep the show interactive. You can email us at live@thebike.com. You can also follow a live thread start on the internet. You can go to 2plus2.com, spell out, click on forums, World Poker Tour, etc. And, got a new player here coming in seat six. It's Jonathan. Dave, there are two 2+2 guys out there from Alabama. I actually ran into them. We've seen Jonathan on the show before. I've seen him actually in higher level games. I actually ran into them, you know, reading in other topics for him on 2+2.
Really?
And after this hand, I want Isaac to kind of troll out there with the remote control cam. Maybe we can show him on the 20, hold him in the 30 game. The guy, the truth. Of course, I was writing about how to bang MySpace chicks. There was a big thread a couple months ago on so 2+2. And this guy, his handle name is The Truth, and he wrote quite a bit of useful openers and tips.
I got you.
So I want to give him his due.
That's your contribution to society? Wonderful.
Six-way action here. 10-9-6 here.
Wow, two pair for Al.
Yep.
Nobody else is a 10, but there is a king 9 out there. You wonder if Calvin's going to get involved.
Well, C4 is in position. Well, he's one off the cutoff, and he's going to bet. He bets 15. And Calvin is going to call. He needs a 9 is no good. Like you said, he's going to need to catch a king here. Reversed implied odds if a 9 comes. And look at Alan in seat number 8. He overcalls the gut shot here to the 8. Well, the turn's a 3. Pretty safe card here for 9-10.
Yeah.
If you're ahead on the flop, you're still ahead.
Rainbow board, I mean, the only draw you're really scared of here is Jack Queen, maybe Jack 8.
He bets again here, and Calvin continues to call. I mean, this guy's betting twice. How can you possibly think a 9 is good here?
The first bet you can understand, obviously.
And the river here is a 6. And
that changes nothing. And if I'm out, I'm going to bet strong here.
Yeah, he's built himself a bot, and now he's going to move in.
I like the way he played it. Now, you can on the flop, sometimes you can go, well, this guy's a cutoff seat. Maybe he's trying to steal it. But with a hand like King 9, do I really want to take any heat?
$53 bet into a pot that's now about 120, and this is kind of what you do in deeper stack no limit if you continue to bet. Well, this guy's actually going to get away from it here. Figures he can't really beat that much. So can we take a trip around the casino? We don't do this. I think we should add this to a part of the show.
Take a trip around the casino? Okay.
Yeah. We zoom back out here, and then we head over to the right-hand side. Oh, see that 30 game? See the guy in the blue right there, Dave? There we go. That is Blaine.
What's his name?
The Truth on 2+2. His name
That's
is
the truth?
Blaine. And his buddy's name, I believe, begins with an H. I don't remember his name. But that's the truth guy, Blaine.
That's the truth.
Yep. There he is. Master
Always
of
nice to put
MySpace openers.
Always nice to put a face to the name.
Yep. Button moves over here to us. seat number 7.
So I heard you mention this special event. What special event?
Apparently we're doing a private kind of home game table, Dave. I guess it's, is it going to be a 200 game, Evelyn? Yeah, 200 no limit game. So of course we're not doing the normal 3-5 that we usually do. Got checked around here. Alan's got a flush draw.
Yeah, well, Jonathan's now made 2 pair, aces and eights.
Yes, he does. Ace is up.
Time to get some money to pot.
Bet's 15. You know, Jonathan's, from what I've seen him, when he plays up to the 500, he's played it pretty solidly. Alan's thinking of, this is, of course, the dry flush draw, Dave, here, with one card to come for Alan. He does not call. He does not call. But Al here is going to call with 9-10. Well, if you were going to call, I don't understand why you would bet. And the river here is a 7. Maybe he thinks the guy is on a steal.
I wasn't sure. Oh, okay. I don't know.
And I assume that Jonathan's probably
you've got to bet this.
Going to bet for value here again, right? Yeah. Yes.
Yeah, obviously. Now, you got to think, if you're one away from the button there, like Al was, if you think your hand is good, bet it. If you don't, throw it away. Now you're putting yourself in a spot where you've induced this bluff and you have no idea if you're good or not. But he's not going to call here. Now, funny there, I guess he was calling for a gut shot or maybe 2 pair of trips, but with 2 diamonds and 2 clubs out there, how do you know your opponent's not actually betting his flush draw?
Yeah, there aren't a whole bunch of cards that are going to help him there.
No, not at all.
River comes 10. It's a 1 card straight anyways on the board to the jack. And Jonathan still has a better hand with AC. But moves over here to seat number 8. Yeah, you know, I wasn't doing much this weekend. I was actually sick, and I actually caught kind of a resurgence of a little cold I had last week. Came back to me. I think it was probably the drinking on Friday night brought it back. So I was just kind of trolling around MySpace, trying to improve my page.
Right, and I'm just curious. How was your drunken affair after the show ended? King Jack 7 here.
Get to that in a second here. John has got a flush draw and a straight draw.
Yeah, it's a nice flop for John.
Wow, look at this. He's got the flush here.
And he also has he doesn't have a straight flush draw. Flop for a second, he did.
And now John is going to bet 15 here.
He's going to take this down.
Yep. Looks like he is going to take it down there. I was doing fine. You know, it's funny. I actually said at one point, you know, in the beginning of the show, it went crazy. And then at one point, I was like, oh, man, I got to start taking some voluntary shots. But then at the end of the night, I think I had to take, like, about 4 quick shots to top everything off. I was in a little bit of a daze.
I mean, I walked in here
towards the end of the night.
And you were totally fine. And then in the span of 20 minutes, you did 4 shots.
Yeah, but wasn't that before you came in, though, I had to do those shots?
No, right when I came in, it was boom, boom,
boom.
Oh,
really?
It was like diamonds, sixes, nines.
Yeah. Again, Dave and I are going to try to play more on Friday nights, right? Of course, I won't be here this Friday, and I don't know if you've gotten word as to who you're going to bring back here on the booth.
I think it's actually going to be kind of if it's okay with my producer, of course.
Potluck.
No, it's kind of like a smorgasbord of people.
Yeah.
Maybe even we'll have Alan back here for 10 minutes and... You know, Justin Castellani back here for 10 minutes and so forth.
Jonas, I think
Jonas maybe
can get him down here. Queen 10-8 here. Now, Jonathan's got top two. Top two pair. Couple clubs out there. And he's going to bet. He's going to bet 20. And seat number 7 here has got 9-7. He's going to raise with an open-end straight draw here, Dave. Well, there are 2 clubs out there, and you know what? It's not really a great straight draw that he has.
I mean, if the 6 comes out, okay. If it's a red 6, I'll take it.
Now
if
that Jack comes and look out, this, now that Al overcalls in between, I think Jonathan with these stack sizes really should push here.
Yeah, definitely. That board is way too scary.
I can't believe he's just calling. I mean, with 200, this is only a 200 game. With top 2 there, my money's going in. Well, now the turn's a club.
Yeah, now he's going to scare himself.
Yep.
And you almost have to assume one of these guys is on a flush draw, don't you?
I mean, you would think that Al would have overcalled with maybe like the nut flush draw, even though he probably shouldn't because he doesn't have that much money. And I think this one's going to... No, Jamie's going to bet now.
He's going to try to represent.
Well, that's 25 here, Dave.
Yeah, now, the funny thing is if he represents there, if he puts Jonathan to the test...
Jonathan calls.
I don't know if Jonathan calls.
He's going to have to bet the river if he misses. And the river here is an 8. So he does miss. Maybe he's just trying to build himself a little bit more of a pot so he can leave himself enough money to bluff at it here at the river.
Just another way to go, yeah.
But he's going to have to put all the money in.
Yeah, he's going to have to move all in. No, this is a gift.
He bets 30. Yeah, that is just...
That's a gift.
Not knowing how much to bet, as we often see.
And his instincts are right. I mean, he raises there, get himself a free card. He doesn't take the free card, and he goes, you know what, maybe I can represent clubs here.
Yeah.
The other guy didn't bet it, but just didn't bet enough. Now, I'm not sure if Jonathan gets away from it or not, but if you put some big heat on it, Jonathan might just cry and call. Maybe he lays it down. You never know.
Looks like we're going to see our first chip count here of the night.
Got almost $5,000 on the table. Look at Calvin. Wow. Almost $1,800 there. Let's see how they're doing. There it is. John's up 545. Now, this is from the beginning of the show, obviously. Calvin there actually down 130 since the beginning of the show. Nathan down 310. And John up 545. Pretty much all in that first hand. And we'll keep track of that all night and see how these guys are doing.
Button moves over here to seat one.
You get a raise here from Calvin. He's raising it up with 3-6 suited.
Yeah, it looks like he's going to take it down here.
Yeah,
dude.
Nobody's going to call him. So that's funny, you were telling me about a hand that you played on Friday night.
Oh, you know.
Where, I mean, that just has an awful beat where...
When I actually played a little bit of 5-10 right after the show, but then around 1 or 2 o'clock in the morning, the only game that was going was a 10-20 game, Dave, and there was a guy that had $400 in front of him, two stacks of brown. 45 minutes later, he had 18,000.
Jeez, what a rush. I mean, that's insane.
And I will tell you one of the big hands that he won, which was against me, and I'll get to it here in a second. Looks like we got pocket kings here.
Yeah, and seat number two, Reggie's got tens, and seat number one has got nines. Wow, and seat three has got sevens.
So Nathan has opened for 15 here.
And we've got four pocket pairs.
45.
And John is going to re-raise to 45. And I'm really, well, let's see, you know, maybe...
Wow.
Maybe Brian is calling Dave because... He's deep enough.
Well, actually, Reggie called first.
Well, okay, Reggie's got tens, but I mean, and Brian and Reggie, now Brian calls, he's deep enough.
And Nathan, just move in.
All those guys are so deep here, Dave, that they might think they can hit each other's sets.
Of course, but now if you're Nathan, though.
Oh, I can't believe. Oh, yeah,
Nathan,
he
moved all in. And it's only 55 more, though.
And that's not going to, that can open it up to a re-raise. He has re-raised. And somebody could re-raise here. Now, John just calls. Reggie is just going
to
call.
And now if you're Brian, you're deep enough, you have to call.
Yeah.
I mean, you're already getting 3-1 on your money, plus possible implied odds. You have to call this.
I mean, this pot is going to be about $400 pre-flop here, and it is.
Sevens, nines, tens, and kings.
$400 in the main pot, and Nathan did push there.
Now, seat number three is already checked blind.
Has he? Okay.
And there's a set of tens.
Yeah,
look at Reggie.
Set here for Reggie. And this pot is big enough, Dave, where I wouldn't really screw around here. And he's gonna move in.
Wow.
He moves in for 500 here. Well.
Okay, I understand not screwing around, but you play that hard? I mean, I guess if somebody's got ace king, you don't want to keep them sticking around there. Maybe a jack comes off.
Turns a deuce. Nathan needs a king and only a king, and does not come. And
Reggie's
gonna take
for Reggie.
Down the pot. Yeah, I mean, I might bet 250 there or something, 200 or 150, yeah, something. Anyways, so, yeah, listen to this hand, right? So we've been playing, and I'm up about a couple grand. And I got pocket deuces on the button. We're playing six-handed. It's limped around five ways. The flop comes 9-4 deuce with three spades. Guy in the cutoff bets to me, okay? Bets like 100. I raise him to 375. Everybody folds. He calls. Remember, three spades on board. I've got bottom set. The turn is the queen of clubs. He checks. I bet 600. He calls. The pot is now about 2,000. The river is the fourth spade, but it pairs the queen. So the board now is 9-4 deuce, queen, queen with four spades.
So you got twos full.
Twos full.
Great.
He checks the river. I bet like 1,000.
Now
the pot
bet
is like 3,000.
Figuring maybe you'll get even paid off by, yeah, say, an ace or a king or
spades,
some sort of spade.
Yeah.
Right.
He check raises me all in, Dave, on the river.
Now how much more did he have?
I think it was 2,800 total, so it was 1,800 more. So the pot was 6,800, 1,800 for me to call.
And you've got twos full.
Oh, man. I mean, there's no way I'm going anywhere. And he turns over queen nine. I mean, that is brutal.
Yeah. I mean, you'd think sometimes.
And I thought the guy was bad enough where he might do that with just the ace of spades. I mean, there was no way I'm going to go anywhere.
Right, right. I mean, you'd think if he had the nine in his hand, top pair on a flop, you'd think he at least had the queen of spades in his hand. But he had a nine with a red queen, I assume? I mean, that's insane.
Yeah. Four-way action here. Get a raise by Jonathan. He made it 15. He's going to get checked over here to Brian, and he's going to bet. 35.
Yeah, pretty straightforward here.
He bets 35.
And Calvin's calling this with second pair. Third pair, I'm sorry, bottom pair.
Bottom pair. Bottom pair, no kicker here, Dave.
And the question is, I'm not quite sure what he's trying to hit here, because there's two clubs out there.
Yeah.
I mean, if a four comes off and it's a club, how do you even know if you're good? Well, now he's picked up a wheel draw. He can catch a three or four or a five. But you wonder if he can play it aggressively, being out of position. And Brian's going to bet again, it looks like.
125? Yeah, he's going to bet 125 now.
And that'll probably win it. Yeah, Calvin looks like he's throwing his hand the way he does. And the river would have been a four.
That would have given him two
pair. Pair, yeah.
I had some good Cuban food over the weekend. I went to the original Versailles over there in Venice.
Oh, wow, that is good.
On Venice Boulevard.
Yeah.
Some garlic chicken, fried plantains, brown beans,
yeah,
rice. Yeah. Had a Cuban sandwich. Or part of a Cuban. We just wanted to try a Cuban sandwich.
Right.
Split that. New player coming in here, seat 8.
Yeah, Nathan's going to move over there to seat number... I'm sorry, Alan's going to move over to seat number 9.
Buttonier's got an ace, 10 of hearts here, seat number 4. And seat 2 is going to raise it up. He's going to make it 25 to go. Looks like he's got a king 9 off suit.
Now, Al's going to smooth call at the ace 10 suited on the button, and they're going to see this heads up. And 10-8-6 flop there.
And Reggie, I mean, he immediately comes out and bets. He bets 50. And, you know, if Al's going to play short stack, he makes the call. I wonder if he missed, though, if he was just going to fold. I mean, short stack obviously is a different strategy.
And you wonder. And the problem with this now, you look at Reggie sitting there going, well, I'm pot committed.
Yeah, it's 20
now.
More.
20 more, and the pot's 150.
Yeah, he's getting almost 8 or 9 to 1 here. He's with one over, he can definitely
He's
call.
Open-ended now.
The river's a 10. Yeah, he was open-ended, or a king would have been good as well. This email here from Tony D. I have a physical tell on Dave.
Wow.
Unbelievable.
Said, hey, guys, this email is more for Dave when he was playing in the game on Friday. Many of you that missed last Friday's show, I was actually playing. The game kind of started off a little shorthanded on Cinco de Mayo. And I figured I'd play in it.
Yeah, it was really fun.
Yeah, it was a good game. Kind of a little passive table.
You did well, like you were... You didn't really play that much. I mean, you didn't play that many hands. I
no,
mean,
it was
the table did fill back up.
Right, it was kind of a passive calling station table. Yeah. I was sitting next to Hobbin, he and I were discussing it. It was kind of one of those tables where you kind of just needed to pick up some hands.
Right.
And you'll get paid off.
Loose passive, right?
Yeah. I mean, unless you can pick up. But, you know, once in a while you can pull off against the right guy.
Limped around here.
Raise.
And seat number 5 is going to raise. He's got ace queen.
40 total.
And he's going to make it 40 to go. Now, Eric, we've seen him on the show a lot. He's got a king, queen, and diamonds here, Dave. He makes the fold, which is really correct here with his stack size, just coming into the game with $200. You don't want to be calling off about, say, 25% of your chips there with king, queen suited.
No, not usually.
Yeah. But Alan calls with queen, eight, and he's pretty much called about 80% of his stack. And the flop comes king, seven, six here. Alan checks. Calvin checks right behind him.
There's
turns
the ace.
An ace. Well, maybe Alan's got a white chip under there, Dave. I can't quite tell. Okay, I'm getting word that he does.
Still, though, obviously with queen eight suited, it's not really the hand you want to go to war with.
No.
And there is the white chip for Alan. Good to see that surfing a line ace. First week in Vegas. Was doing well on
net profit.
Yeah. Yeah.
If he keeps that up, he's making over $100,000 a year, huh?
That's not bad.
I don't really know how much you can really beat a set. I mean, he says he's played 17 hours at 2-5 no limit and 5 hours at 5-10. I assume the 2-5 no limit game is a 200 calf game like that Bellagio. I mean, what would be an hourly in that game? You could never make over, say, $30 an hour.
Well, the only thing is, in a game like that, I would say, I mean, I saw it. A lot of my friends were playing it this weekend.
If you get deep, you can win some money, right?
Yeah. And it seemed like the game was always going, so somebody was deep.
Right.
Rarely started new.
So it's like your first couple hours of the game, your hourly is going to be a lot less than the final few hours of your session.
Of course, yeah. So obviously, if you can build up your stack, too.
Brian is raised here to 30. He's got pocket aces.
Now, Alan has king-queen. We saw he couldn't get rid of queen-eight before, so you figure king-queen's a monster for him.
And he makes the call here, Dave. More heads up. If he catches a king-queen, you wonder if he's going to get himself into trouble. Well,
lucky for him he didn't catch it.
Brian's going to bet 75 here with the overpair, and he's going to take it down. Button moves over here to seat-eight. Brian's got some ink there on his arms, huh? Wow. Have you ever tattooed anywhere?
I don't.
No.
I'm sorry. My wife and I are talking about getting one, though.
Oh, not one of those cheesy husband-wife tattoos.
Yeah, that's what I want to get.
Wait, like on your ankle? Like the little love sign?
No, I want to put one right on my ass, okay? I'm going to put one right on my ass. Melissa was here, okay?
Limp in.
Right.
Limp in nearby seat four. Supposedly nowadays you can actually get tattoos pretty easy, like get them removed pretty much.
Right, with laser surgery or something? Yeah.
You know, or it's not really surgery, it's like a treatment, you know. Yeah. But before, a tattoo was a tattoo there for to stay.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So a limp in here by ace queen, and Jamie's raised it up here to 15 with ace 10.
And ace queen's a hand that you can get in trouble with, but in this case, Al's in great shape.
Four-way action here, limped around. Deuce 3-4. No one has any part of this flop. It's deuce 3-6, excuse me. And Jamie is going to bet here into three other players.
Well, he'll probably take this down.
He's going to bet 40.
I mean, he was the pre-flop of Razor. I figured everybody checked to me. Okay, I'll take a shot at it.
Now, this is always, Al hasn't done anything. It's always, you know, we see it. It's not necessarily just at the lower levels, Dave, when somebody, and look at this, he makes the call. Not necessarily slow playing a hand, but doesn't raise with usually a hand that would be considered premium, and then makes a call on a board like this.
Right. Well, now, Jamie has picked up a wheel draw.
And,
so is Al.
And the nut, and he's gonna bet here again. He moves in. I mean, we see a player like Alan at the 5-10 and the 10-20 do this all the time with ace-queen and ace-king.
Take one off.
I mean, it's not limit hold'em. You can lose a lot to aces up or somebody who flopped some other bigger hand that's bigger than one pair on the flop, right?
Well, I mean, why couldn't the guy have pocket eights, pocket nines? Who knows? I mean, if you think the guy is weak, go ahead and raise him. See where you're at.
But I'm saying sometimes when you get there, though, on the turn with your ace or your king,
oh, you're no good,
behind.
Right. Definitely.
Yeah. Button moves over here to seat 9.
I mean, you got to figure in that case, okay, maybe my queen is probably safe.
Yeah, it would be difficult. But I mean, you know, people bet sets, flop straight, something like that.
Of course.
You never know. Was it hot in Vegas?
Is it
gotten really hot there?
Seriously, it kind of like skipped the 80s. Today was 95 degrees there.
You know, it's been a really, really cool kind of winter and spring here in L.A. I mean, I remember there was one day in January where it was like 95, but the last 2 months, have we had any weather like above 70 during the day?
No, it's been
I mean, you live up in the valley, so it might be either warmer or colder.
Yeah, I live in actually the mountains of Burbank.
Right. No, but I mean, it'll get to 100 at your house, where at my house it really doesn't get above 85.
Right.
I mean, there is a difference there.
No, no, definitely. Yeah. But no, it's definitely been a cool winter and a cool spring, I guess.
Yeah.
But Vegas was kind of cool, you know, hang out at the pool, 90 degrees.
At the Bellagio pool?
Yeah.
How's that? Is that like, is that the one where they have the European section, or is that the Wynn where you can go topless? I think that's the Wynn.
Yeah, no, topless section.
And you were telling me that you wanted.
I mean, I was topless.
Right. You were telling me you wanted to check out some of the other, like the Palms, but you never got over
there. We were thinking about going over to the Palms and stuff, but we didn't really. It ended up being just 2 days. So we went to the Wynn and went to basically stayed at Bellagio. That was it.
Reggie is raised here to 15. Al is called Jack 10. And Alan's in there, 6-7 of diamonds. Three-way action here.
Oh, nice flop for 7-6. Now, Reggie's got top pair, though.
Yeah, and he's going to lead right out.
And he's behind Alan here. You wonder if he's going to get himself in trouble.
That's 45. And, I mean, look at the stack sizes. I mean, he can basically, why wouldn't you move in here?
Oh,
he's got,
easy.
70 left. I think he wants to slow play it, Dave, but he can't. And he's going to call.
And Reggie's going to call this, I'm sure, and he's got outs, though.
Yeah. Catch a 9. Or a 9 hearts.
Oh, there's a heart.
There's a heart. He needs a 9 or a heart here. And the river's a heart, and Reggie's going to make the backdoor flush.
And this is one of those times you can't really, you don't berate the player like Reggie in that case. I mean, what is he going to do? The pot's $120. It's 20 to call.
Right, right.
Getting 6-1 with top pair.
Did you get to catch any of that miserable Lakers game on Saturday? I mean, they never had a chance.
It was awful.
Yeah.
I actually gave my buddy at the end of the third quarter.
I mean, I was really looking forward to go to a Lakers-Clippers game at Staples.
I couldn't believe it. The Lakers just, I don't know what happens there. Completely choked. But I gave my buddy at the end of the third quarter, we were going out to dinner, and I go, okay, I'm offering 50-1 odds on the Lakers can't win. And I said, minimum bet $10. So I had two of my buddies take up on it.
Pay them $500?
$500 for their $10 bet.
You were rooting against the Lakers, then.
They were down by 25. I figured I'd make $20 off of it.
You know, if you were at a sports book, I wonder if you could have actually gotten the real odds there from somebody if they do those prop bets. Like the money line odds at, like, right around the third quarter? It was probably something like that.
Oh, man. It was
50-1. But,
I got the Kentucky Derby winner, though. I was quite excited with that. Did you get to watch the Derby?
I did.
Yeah.
How was how were the sports books there when the Derby's going on? Are they packed?
The Bellagio is crazy.
In the sports book?
Oh, it's just insane, yeah.
Because that, of course, is right next to the poker room, so it's just like...
Absolutely insane.
Yeah.
But it was kind of cool. You know, it's a nice atmosphere. If you can't be in, you know...
Were they serving mint jubilees or juleps?
Mint juleps,
Mint juleps? Were they?
They weren't, like, just handing them out, but, yeah, you could order them.
Well, I think you always can order them.
Yeah.
He had a raise here by Al, and Jamie is called with a queen 10. Reggie's in there with 6-3 off suit.
Well, not really a good flop for anybody.
No, not a good flop for Al, a pre-flop raiser. And it's going to get checked around here. Turns king, and now Jamie has a straight.
Yeah, he's got the nuts right now. Cannot lose a
25.
And Jamie's going to take this down. Yeah, no, it's a great atmosphere. A couple of years ago, I was in Vegas for the Kentucky Derby with my wife, and we really, really enjoyed it. Now, I can't wait to actually go to Churchill Downs to watch it.
I don't necessarily know if you just say, like, oh, I can go. I think you need to, like, be a member of, like, society.
Member of society? I am a member of society.
Oh, yeah.
I recently signed up.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Nobody clued me in.
Yeah. but it was actually a crazy weekend being, they were like, between Cinco de Mayo, the Kentucky Derby, and the De La Hoya fight, it was absolutely
was
insane.
Was the De La Hoya fight held in Vegas, too?
Yeah.
Mirage.
I would think it was MGM, actually, I want to say.
20.
Or hurting.
I had no desire to go, whichever casino it was at, I didn't want to go there. That was for sure.
We have a $20 raise here by Jonathan. We need to see his cards. He's under the gun.
No. And if you actually look at it and are considering it.
And seat number 4 is going to call here with Queen 8 suited. So Jonathan's brought this one in with Ace Jack of Diamonds. Pretty nice flop here for Al.
Yeah, not bad at all.
And he's going to move in.
And Jonathan cannot call. Even a small bet like that, he can't call.
And again, it's funny how we definitely preach not to play backwards, but in this game, I think if you make a call to a raise and you only have, say, $50, $60, $70, and you intend, if you hit a piece of it, I think you should check and let the guy bet so that he commits himself.
Yeah, I mean, it also applies to the bigger game if you're short stack.
Right.
I mean, it's almost like, I actually want to say it's short stack theory.
Right.
You probably check raise more with your big hands.
Yeah.
Forcing your opponent to actually call you.
But
I mean, obviously, if you're playing in a 10-20 game and you've only got $600 left or $500 left,
right.
You have ace-king and you can check raise a guy, why not do it?
And Jamie here, he's going to bet 20. He's raised to 20. He's got pocket aces.
Now, you know Calvin can call this. He's got pocket deuces. And he's already in a small blind.
Well, can Calvin call there if it was just seat number 7 who was raising? And look at this. And
now you can definitely call. If it was just seat 7, probably not, because seat 7 doesn't have enough money.
Right.
But since seat 1 has money and seat 3 has money, Calvin's definitely going to call it those deuces.
So we're probably going to see this four ways. $80 pot here, Dave. Aces, deuces, king, ten of clubs, and queen, jack off suit.
There's a deuce.
There's the deuces here. And now John's got top pair, and Jamie has the over pair.
Yeah.
And Calvin checked the deuces from up front.
Now, seat number 3, Brian has nothing. He's got a lot of money.
And Calvin is going to bet 50. And let's see what John is going to do here. And I got to tell you, if John calls... And then Calvin, this really should get Jamie off the hook. If John calls here and Calvin puts a big check raise in, that means that Calvin is check raising John, and both those guys are deep. I think aces should fold. Now, it might seem easy to us, and he's moved in here. So, Dave, he's moved in. This is a $600 all-in here. And, of course, we talk about, because remember, John has 600 left in seat one, and he's still in the hand.
Wow, he moved all in?
Yep. And again, this probably should get aces off the hook here. And we always talk about if Calvin had bet out, he would have won a lot more money than he is by doing this.
Well, he's let him off the hook. Now, I'm not sure. Going in with Jamie, though, I mean, what does he have left?
Well, yeah, I mean, that is the other. Well, he's got about 150 left. But what I was going to say
is, I mean, how do you not? I mean, you're saying he gets him off the hook. Can't Calvin ace king? King queen?
Do you think that, well, again, you know, I haven't.
I mean, you got to put him on a set of deuces or a set of fours here. That's it.
Well,
you can't have a set of kings.
But remember, look at the board, though. I mean, would you, because John is in there and he is deep, would you really think that Calvin would commit all his chips with ace king or commit six, maybe in this game, 600 or 700? Aces.
Well, I mean, that's the only thing. I think if
turn is an 8 here.
Yeah, not going to change anything here.
And the river's a 10.
Yeah, and John had actually folded his king 10 very quickly. Would have made two pair on the river. Wow. You wonder if seat number 1, John, if he really would have gone, lost a lot of money there if he waited to the river.
But, I mean, maybe it might be a little bit of a stretch, Dave, but again, the point is that...
I understand the course.
The point is how it lets people off the hook, because usually when somebody check raises, especially against a non-dry heavy board...
Hey, of course, if I've got $600 or $700 and I have aces there,
yeah,
I definitely have to start thinking about it, but if I only have $120 left...
Right.
And the pot is, say, 250. I don't know. I mean, all the guy has to have is ace-king, say, 1 out of 3 times for me to make that call correct. We say goodbye to Jamie there.
You know, it's funny. Vegas, there's always an event going on. And I don't know, like, what convention was there. But then when there's a major boxing match like there was... That brings even, like, more people, celebrities in there, right?
Oh, yeah. Almost every casino I went into was sold out. All hearts out there, and Eric has flopped the flush.
Shanghai flush. Now, is that because of the boxing match, you think?
They said it was a combination of a lot of things. They said it was, like you said, actually, 2 weeks ago was, like, kind of unofficial opening of swim season for Vegas.
Now, we have a bet here by Jonathan. He's bet with Jack 7 with top pair. We don't have it up there. And Eric is going to min-raise here with the king high flush. He's not going to let anybody linger around. Or another reason why you would raise here is to get action if someone else flopped the smaller flush.
Wow.
And he gets a call here by Jonathan anyways.
I'm surprised.
And Jonathan is drawing dead to a running full house, and that's it here, folks. Jonathan checks, and Eric should continue to build this pot up. And he bets again.
75.
That's 75. And, you know, There's no way Jonathan's sticking around with the seven of hearts. If he made the call him a flop, you still think his, he thinks his hand is good now?
You wonder if he's not familiar with Eric's play also. Yeah. I mean, obviously, you and I know Eric a lot better than he does. We know Eric's got something here. But you got to look at this hand, though. You have Jack 7. What can you beat? I mean, do you think this guy's just got ace of hearts?
Yeah, and he's out of there.
And he throws it away. Yeah, I think between
opening and swim season.
Opening and swim season. Yeah. May is kind of, I mean, I think April and May are probably two of the best months in Vegas because it's not yet that hot.
It's not oppressively hot like it is in the summertime.
Right.
Like when they place the World Series during the time when you can't even walk outside, right?
It's unreal, I swear. Yeah. It's actually terrible. But anyway.
The World Series used to be in May, April, right?
Well, because, you know, the Binions, he had it going right. He didn't really want to take advantage of the poker players like Harris does.
Oh. All comes down to that corporate blabber.
Of course it is. The corporate bullshit. They look at it and they go, well, how can I possibly make more money? Well, we can't get anybody to come to Vegas in July and August except poker players.
Is that really the slow season, though, in Vegas in July and August?
Well, it's got to be slower than May.
How many
August nights do you spend in Vegas? I mean, it's 110 degrees there. Who the hell wants to go to Vegas then?
Limped around here, and seat number 9 is pushed in. Here, king, queen suited. I would just think that maybe some of the colder seasons a little bit slower. But I see what you're saying.
Because you have holiday seasons also around there. I mean, New Year's is obviously very crowded. I mean, I'll put it this way. There's no coincidence. Alan takes it down. No coincidence that Harris bought the World Series and immediately moved to the summer, you know, July and August.
Harris does not own Binions anymore, right?
No, they sold Binions. They kept the name. They just kept the World Series. But either way, between Cinco de Mayo, which is kind of like, you know, it's a holiday that a lot of people like to celebrate, whether they're Mexican or not.
Right.
Between De La Hoya.
I mean, there's a Cinco de Mayo every day in Vegas with those yard drinks. I remember when I go there, you know. You ever had one of those?
I have it.
Strawberry daiquiris or the... Even at Luxor. me and my buddy stopped at that bar, that room that, you know, that Shirley used to help us out with. They had some great yard drinks. And I hate those theme hotels, man.
And Alan makes it $20 to go with king-queen.
Yeah, offsuit.
And John is going to call it an ace-10.
Three-way action here.
And Alan calls it the big lick. And there it is, big lick.
Big lick, bottom two.
Wow, and you wonder if Alan's going to double up here because John's got top pair.
John's got ace-10, top pair, best kicker. And John is going to come out and bet. Alan checked. He was the pre-flop raiser. See how Al's going to play it.
Now, I don't think Al has very much money. Why not just move in? He does.
And again, ace-10, you know, you're going to call here. There's just so many things that you might beat here at the combination of you might catch up if you're beat for some reason.
This is part of this game that's kind of frustrating in the sense that it is so short stack sometimes where you can't really get away from ace-10 here.
No. And you shouldn't. Turns a 6, and that's going to do it here unless ace-10 catches a 10.
Wow.
And the river is a 9. A double full house here.
Yeah.
For 9-6. 9's full. There it is.
Take it down, Al. And he doubles up. Well, actually, a little more than doubles up.
So I guess, I mean, the reason why I asked you that was because obviously Binions is probably not going to have the final table, right, next year.
You mean the World Series main event? I would assume not.
Well,
I mean,
it's not owned by the same entity.
Yeah, it's owned by different... Different companies coming and bought that. I love Binions. You know the Binions slogan, by the way? They're trying to get people to play poker there. They go, play poker at Binions. Why? Because it's fun. Who came up with that one?
Oh, man.
What advertising team came up with that one, huh?
Actually, you know, it's funny. I was reading something. The only reason why I would head down to Binions now is to take a look at Benny Binions' $10,000 bill collection, which, you know, they've stopped circulating bills over $100 in denomination, like in 1955. Apparently, Benny Binion has, or the Binion Casino. And maybe that's owned by Harris now, too, so maybe they don't even have it. You know, Harris might have bought that as well.
They might have, I don't know. I mean, they obviously bought all of Binion's and then kind of kept what they wanted to keep and sold
it. Right,
or
maybe the Binion family kept it, obviously. Reggie's going to raise here with Queen Jack offsuit. Al is called here. 4-5 offsuit. Alan is going to call.
And imagine we're going to see this four ways now.
Yeah. About an $80 pot here four ways, dude.
King Jack.
How about a flop straight here for Allen?
Not bad at all. He's got backdoor hearts, backdoor clubs as well.
Yeah, look at Reggie. Reggie's flop middle pair here in a straight draw. He's going to bet 35. And look at Allen shake his head.
Oh, man, what do I do?
I know.
The funny thing is, I mean, he's playing it coy like as if he had like $4,000.
Look at this. He wants, he's going to slow play it. He's got 35 left. Oh, man. Unbelievable. Turns a 7. Now he picks up a club draw as well.
Yeah, and Reggie is drawing dead to
bet.
Tie only.
Yeah.
He can catch a 10 to tie this, and that's it.
I'm sure you can download some things. What? I mean, Reggie's bet here. I don't know what Allen's thinking about. There's no more money to be made.
Yeah, just double checking it, I guess. I don't know.
He calls. Well, Reggie needs a 10 to chop. And the river's a king.
You're not going
to
do it, obviously. Allen makes it straight, wins it. Reggie's two pair is no good.
I don't think you guys want me there. Happy game.
There it is.
And Allen is Allen, that's Allen. Allen has threatened to play in this Monday game and kind of stir things up.
Oh, let him buy in for as much as he wants. That'll be fun, huh? buy in for like 1,000. There he is.
There he is, the myth, the legend.
I go blind all in every hand.
Oh, come to it, Allen.
I know, like the players are scared of that or something. No, don't do that, please. New player in seat number 7. His name is Matthew.
From there? Take a good look
again. Yeah. Well, he was here from the beginning. He saw me.
Long time watcher. First time performer.
Yes.
Matthew.
Hopkins. Or my best friend today.
That's not the bleeding boy.
Somebody check that kid's ID.
He's got some rosy cheeks, huh?
Yeah. We need seat 3 to show. Oh, procedure 3's got 7s here. Now, John is raised with ace-queen on the button.
I tell you, Brian has had 7s like 6 times.
And he calls. The Jack 3 is in the hand here. Wow.
Well, everybody's missed. Brian is still in the lead, but the king is out there, and you wonder if it's a scary card for him.
But ace queen is not bet here. Now the turn's a 4, and you got to think maybe Brian's going to throw a bet out here with 7s. And he bets 45. You know, it's so funny. I was playing in the 5-10 game this afternoon.
Yes.
And it's just amazing that people at that level still don't know how to really play no-limit cash games. What I mean by that is there was a guy that was playing it really tight. I had played it, you know, not that tight, a little bit loose. I had raised with queens.
You crazy, man.
It was 3-way action. The flop came 6-7-3. He checked me. I bet. The other guy folded. He looked and checked and kind of shook his head coyly and called. The turn paired middle pair. He checked me. I actually checked behind him, Dave, because I really thought he was behind. And the river was...
You thought you were behind.
I thought I was behind. And the river was a king. And he bet $250 into a $600 pot, and I folded, and he showed me a set of 3s. And again, if he had actually played the hand properly, how little money, and even if I called the river,
right.
How little money he made on that hand.
And the way he coyly played it, you really thought he must
and
have
bet
lost
on
it.
The king, too, at the end.
Right.
You know? And people just don't, like I said, I mean, this supposedly this Ed Miller, either Sklansky book or... It's a 2+2 book about no-limit theory supposed to come out at the end of the month. I really wonder how well that's going to be written. And
Big flop here for
Jonathan.
For Jonathan in seat number 6.
Nut
top pair
draw.
With the nut flush draw. Now, if he gets any heat, he's got to realize that he's probably behind to a bigger ace, and then he's behind, actually. He would need on 12 outs to the win.
3 players.
6 on the turn.
Well, 2 people called him. King 10 got shot to the queen and Reggie. And now Jonathan's going to bet here again.
45.
Oh, no. Are they really? They're kicking that kid out of there, Dave. That is hilarious. Look at seat 7. He's gone. 94.
Yes.
Oh, no. Don't say anything. I'm sorry. So Reggie raised here with Ace Deuce, and Jonathan is called. Reggie made the min raise with Ace Deuce here, Dave. And the river is a heart, and you want, well, now, I was maybe wondering if Reggie was going to take a free showdown on the river.
You wonder that.
And now Jonathan moves it.
I notice that Jonathan does not put his chips in the pot when he moves all in. Now, keep that in mind. Now, if you play on the internet and you watch the show and you're not 21, if you come to the casino, they will check your ID.
Yeah. Okay.
You're welcome to come here. Just wait till you're 21. Then come.
Well, Reggie's trying to figure out. I mean, he can't beat anything out there. 168. He raised the turn. Now the guy's moved in on the river after the guy bet the flop and bet the turn, Dave. 168. It's about a. It's getting about 2-1. The pot's about maybe 350. 168 to call. Wow, that is really amazing.
That really is. I mean, Reggie can beat nothing.
Yeah.
Nothing at all. I mean, you look at that flop. Ace Jack 7. The only draw out there is hearts. Okay. So if the guy had an ace, he had you beat because you have a deuce. Now if he had hearts, he got there. What else could he have? I mean, what did he miss that he's trying to buy the pot with in the river, right?
One of the funniest things is what I just learned is that, do you know that Gore?
Gore?
You know Gore?
I do know Gore.
Gore had his 21st birthday only about 5 months ago. The guy looks like he's like 35. Gore. He's 21.
You funny, funny boy, Bart. Silly, silly, funny,
Button
funny.
Button moves over here to seat three. No, what I mean is he looks older than his age.
Yeah, I know. But he's really, I mean, I know he's really 25.
No. He never played when he was under 21 on the show. That wasn't my point. Point is how old he looks. He's
right.
Almost 22 now. That really was my point. Don't you think he looks older than that?
Yeah, no, definitely. Yeah. I would say I thought he was like 27 or 28.
Right,
or
right, right.
But
that's how old Jonas is.
Who won that fight?
Button raises over here to 20.
I mean, it's funny about, you're talking about players, some people like this kid obviously coming down here without an ID.
Right.
I'm not sure if he's 21 or not or doesn't have an ID. Who knows? Right, he said he was, but he didn't have ID. I mean, how many places do you go without ID?
If you look like Gore, I think you know, if you look like a guy like Gore and you were 19.
You drive there. Don't you have your ID or not?
Right.
The funniest thing is those last year at the World Series of Poker during the main event.
Oh, I remember they had disqualified a bunch of guys.
There were like, I mean, there were like 10 or 12 spots that were just chips were empty for hours on end. And it was players, kids that had won seats on the internet, but didn't even bother showing up because they knew they couldn't play. They also couldn't transfer their seat.
Right, they couldn't transfer. They couldn't sell it somehow. So, I mean, at least it's a free trip, right, Vegas?
I guess, yeah.
Butt moves here to seat number 9.
I mean, I don't know how cool it is if you're under 21, a free trip to Vegas.
Well, it depends, I guess, on which casinos, you know, allow you to. Five-way action. King, Jack, 5 here with a couple of clubs. Interesting post here on 2+2 by KevMath giving us some information about the World Series of Poker in upcoming years. Turns a 7 of hearts. 15. And now Reggie is going to bet out on a heart draw. He's got 9 deuce of hearts.
Raise.
And Calvin in seat 5 here is going to check raise him with queen 5. We don't have it up there.
45.
He makes it 45 to go. He's check raised with a 5 here, maybe. Maybe he thinks that Reggie's stealing. You don't oftentimes see somebody make a move in this game. Calvin is making a move, and he gets the best hand to fold there at 10s. Now, John was open-ended in seat 1, queen 10. There's a 2 flush on either side out there.
Yeah,
he's not
going
to chase.
Can you read this read by Kev Math?
Yeah. Reggie calls. The river's a jack. Wow, Calvin checks. Reggie gives up.
And Calvin's going to take it down here with jacks and fives and a king kicker.
And that's good.
Best 5 cards play in Holden.
Yeah, Kev Matt said that in 2007, supposedly the World Series of Poker is going to be moved back to to its traditional May Day, but they couldn't do it for 2005 and 2006 because there were conventions already planned. Obviously, the Rio space there, I'm sure they hold big conventions there. And boy, those things are planned like years in advance, aren't they?
I guess so,
those convention spaces. That
is so much better.
Nelson said if Jack Binion still owned Binion's, I'm sure the World Series of Poker would still be there.
Oh, definitely.
The $1 million display was sold by Becky Binion several years ago. That was the collection of, I guess,
$10,000
bills.
$10,000
bills. Don't diss them. They're trying to webcast live tournaments in the near future.
I actually wasn't dissing Binion. It was more of their advertising team.
We got a $20 raise here by.
Yeah, Albert made it 25 more.
And I see two and two, three are going to call.
Four players.
Now, seat number three, Brian's got Jack 10 suited. Always an interesting hand to play there. Flop hasn't helped him much. Flop came out 8-6-3, couple of clubs. And seat number two actually has the best hand, Reggie. And he's going to come out and bet it. Look at that.
45.
That's $45 into about a $100 pot. And is Albert going to get involved? He's got king, queen. Queen of clubs. No, he's not. And Reggie takes it down. Nice bet by him.
Straddle here. I'm just going to get an email here from David Mulcahy. Well, I should really work on those reading skills. He is the one that set up the event that's going to be going on tomorrow. No soft playing, he says. Kind of a little experiment that he's doing amongst some of his friends that all play in a home game together.
Oh, sounds great.
$200 no limit. $10 straddle here by seat number one. Or seat number nine, excuse me.
Hey, you want to set this up as a learning experience? Okay, great. Looking forward to it.
Call here in the small blinds. Albert with 10, good old 10-5 offsuit here. Why you would complete with that for an extra $7, I scratch my head. And Alan's going to raise out of the straddle spot. He makes it 20 to go, and he's going to take it down.
Button moves over to seat number seven. Yeah.
Riley J. Matthews. That collection of $10,000 bills were sold for $4.5 million. So there you go. And Greg Ball there from Delaware says that he's gone to the Derby for the last 5 years, and in each year, he bought tickets on eBay the week before. Ticket prices range from $200 to $350 per seat. Well, thank you for the email, Greg, and the society.
Yeah, obviously a member of society as well.
Wow. And that's actually $110,000 bills is $1 million.
Right.
Limped around here, four-way action. Ace, king, six here with a couple of clubs.
Not a great flop for anybody. I mean, I suppose it's a good flop for Brian because diamonds didn't come.
Turns a five. Reggie picks up a flush draw now.
And he's going to bet it.
He's got a real matter-of-fact style of betting. Boom, it's out there. Boom. 25 on the flush draw from up front. You know, I really enjoy, like, dressing up and kind of a, you know, kind of enjoy, like, what you say, like, kind of a...
I'm wondering where this is going. Dressing up in what?
What I mean by, like, the Kentucky Derby, like, kind of, like, almost, like, debutante-ish, aristocratic type events, like, going to, like, something like that. But, you know, if it just wasn't so damn hot there, right here in Kentucky, like, you can get,
right,
like,
right.
95 degrees, you're dressed up like in a...
Would you like wearing, like, a corset?
Yeah, that's what I do, like, wearing it, like, in a corset. Well.
Next year at the Derby, watch part, he'll be twirling his umbrella around.
julep, I think. It's got bourbon in it.
Yeah, it's actually
strange.
At the Bellagio, it was actually a really good drink. I think they kind of put their own little spin on it.
Yeah.
And it was actually pretty good.
Yeah, it's kind of almost like a mojito with bourbon in it instead
of
rum.
Yeah, sort of, yeah.
That sounds good. And mint.
Oh, yeah, if you like mint, hey.
And bourbon, yeah, that sounds like a great combination. It's funny when they cut away to, like, people on TV, like say, like, I remember like, a couple years ago, like, a John Goodman. They're like, oh, how do you like that mint julep? And he drinks it and makes the face like I look like when I was taking my shots of tequila on Friday. Ooh, it's minty. It's julepy. Got a raise here by seat four with king queen suited.
Once again, we're live at the bike, folks. I'm David Zuckerman here with Bart Hansen. And you're watching No Limit Hold'em. Blinds are 3-5.
Yep, 3-5.
Thank you. I always forget if it's 2-5 or 3-5.
King Queen here, same hand, and he's going to make the call. So chances are both of these guys are going to miss. King Queen against King Queen.
Well, let's see who uses position here. Well,
wow, and look at this. Both of them flop top two here, Dave.
And in this case, seat number one is actually on a free roll. Because he's got a heart in his hand.
Right.
20. Al cannot win this hand.
$20 bet here and a check raise. To 40 by John. All in and a call. And like you said, you got a 5% chance here for John to win with running hearts. Well, wow, what are the odds of that? How can both players have top full house there?
Yeah,
that is unbelievable.
Absolutely insane.
King Queen against King Queen.
We'll chop it up.
Jeez. I don't know if that's ever happened before on the show. Wow. It's like John's drinking the good old MGD there, Dave. Beer champions.
Yeah. You know, MGD, I got to say, for a just a regular beer, it's not bad. I mean, it gets the job done, right?
I like High Life myself.
Yeah, I guess that's better.
Bud moves over here to seat 9. Of course, you can email us again at liveatthebike.com. Ferd Hack has emailed us and said, it would be better if you guys would keep the talk about the game, Dave.
Stop talking about other stuff.
Sorry.
I'm sorry, I'll keep him in line. I apologize. I find myself constantly apologizing for you.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I do. It's terrible. I was actually in Bellagio and a couple of people came up to me and said, you're live at the bike. And I said, yeah, and I saw it. Right away I said, I'm sorry about Bart.
Pocket Jacks is raised here on the button. Looks like he made it, what, 75? Are you kidding me? It's a big race in this game. Eric had limped in with 8.
You know what usually happens in this game? Usually you can tell when somebody's got like 9s, 10s, or jacks.
Yeah, because it's like an $80 race.
Exactly.
Right?
And they usually say, I don't want to see a flop.
Right.
Okay. Well, there's a way to play it then. And you want to say to them, listen, you're only going to see a flop if you're behind.
Right.
That's it. There was actually a dealer that, I think he still deals here, who I was playing in this game with a while ago. And sure enough, it was like limp, limp, limp. And this guy made it like $80 with pocket 9s. And he flipped his cards over and he goes, I don't want to see a flop here. I hate 9s. And I tried to explain to him that there probably was a better way to play it.
Yeah.
Than to raise it, say, 19 times the big blind.
Bud's over here in seat 1.
I gotta tell you, our viewers rock. You mentioned something about this Binion's bill collection, and we get like 12 emails about it.
Yep. Well, the funniest thing is, the reason why I bring that up, and the reason why I started looking around on the internet was because kind of something that you complained about off the show one time, and I'll get to that in a second. Get a raise here by Brian. He's gonna make it 50? Oh, 20. 15.
10 more?
15 with 7-9 of clubs. Again, I never really understand these raises with hands that are tough to play out of position. Word is he has a bunch of blues, Dave, and he wants to get rid of them.
I guess so.
So we get about a $100 pot here going 7 ways. Well, he's off the flush draw. Nobody has a deuce. The only person that's got top hand is Jonathan. If he actually were to come out and bet here, he probably would take it down. Of course, it goes check, and Jonathan's going to bet with 7-10. He's going to bet 35 into a $100 pot.
Well, if you're Brian, you can easily call this. You might even be able to raise this. Usually I like to bet my flusters. I don't really want to call there. And look at this, though.
He calls.
Seat number two is in there.
Oh, excuse me. Oh, you know what? It was actually Brian. It was seat number two, Reggie, that raised it pre-flop.
Oh,
and
okay.
Brian's got the 7-9 clubs. And Reggie check calls with queen jack. And
well,
he hits his queen, and Brian makes the flush.
Now, is Reggie going to get himself in trouble
me?
Here? And look, he puts money out there. What, like the flush draw is impossible?
That's 100. He raised it pre-flop with queen jack offsuit out of position. And now Brian, and now he check called the flop, and now he's bet the turn when he's behind. And Brian has just called here.
Yeah.
And the pot is now $400 to the river. And the river's a jack, and now Reggie's made two pair, and he bets it again.
And that changes nothing, though. You've got to realize
that. Now, can you raise the guy, though? It looks like Brian is just going to smooth call the whole way here. And it's going to be a $600 pot. Remember, he's got another 300 behind. You know, maybe if he's got 100, you can raise there.
Okay, I mean, I guess obviously the guy could have a higher flush than you. Could have a full house, could have a set of tens, or a set of queens, or a set of jacks. I don't buy it, though. I mean, he raised in the small blind $15.
Yeah, strange.
Probably Moore has something like queen jack, you know. More likely.
Yeah, email from Thomas Boldrick. He's talking about the build collection. He also says, as far as I'm concerned, unless you like an out-of-date light show, why go downtown? Now, the thing about the Golden Nugget is supposedly kind of a, almost like a comparable hotel to some of the strip hotels, right?
It's a great hotel. I got to tell you, 2 years ago, which was my first time at the World Series, I want to say World Series, what, 2004?
Yeah.
My first trip down there. I stayed at the Golden Nugget.
Did you really?
Yeah, I stayed there the whole...
Oh, because, of course, you know, it's next door to Binion's, right?
It was across the street from Binion's.
Right,
it was great.
Right.
Well, across the street, across Fremont Street.
Right, right.
And that was great. I mean, Golden Nugget was really classy. It was a very nice hotel. And I enjoyed it. Yeah, I don't know why I go down there now, though.
Fried Twinkies. So I'd go there for. Got a raise here by seat two.
There you go.
Or excuse me, seat five, but deuce five off suit.
Bart Hansen in a nutshell. Fried Twinkies.
Well, there's actually a lot of cheap food and cheap drink down there, but it is pretty good. Sleazy. No, I got to agree with you. And Reggie is going to re-raise here with jacks.
And this is what he's going to raise, and you can see it. He makes it $15 with queen jack. With jacks, what's he going to make it?
Looks like more than 100.
Yeah, there you go.
Oh, that's 60. Excuse me. He raises to 60. Now, the guy who brought this one in for a race, he's got deuce five, seat five. He brought it in with garbage. I mean, he'd been playing it pretty tight, and then all of a sudden now he's going to raise under the gun with deuce five off suit.
Yeah. We see George Georgie do this sometimes as well,
right.
And I just don't understand it.
Right.
Like, play tight, play tight, play tight. Okay, now I'm going to mix it up under the gun?
Right. And Jonathan... His hand's pretty much garbage here out of position.
I'd rather call a 2-5.
And Jonathan and Reggie only has 140 left here.
Yeah, and Jonathan's asking him.
If I'm going in, I'm going all in.
If I'm going in, I'm going to move all in here.
Isn't this the...
he's got queen 10. What is he even thinking about?
Isn't this the... What is it? The Scott Lazar hand? Or is it Jason Lazar? That guy.
Scott Lazar.
Scott Lazar.
Yeah, right.
I'll give you a gamble. Queen 10, off suit. Putt moves over here to seat 3.
I mean, I'll tell you, when you go to Vegas, if you've never been there and you've never been downtown, I mean, definitely think it's worth seeing.
Yeah, I think it's definitely worth it.
It was great. I mean, I was really excited that I got to play at Binion's during their last World Series ever played at Binion's. I was really happy about that. I think there's kind of a mystique about the place that the Rio just doesn't have and probably will never have.
Yeah, I mean, the Rio's...
I mean, there's a bit the difference between playing in a convention hall and playing in a real poker room.
Well, the Rio is a convention hall.
Exactly.
It's not a poker room.
Right. I mean, that's the whole difference.
Yeah, yeah.
Some interesting hands out there. We got king-queen suited. We got queen-jack suited. I get
20. And seat 7's going to raise. That is Albert.
King, yeah, he's got the queen-jack suited. And Eric's going to smooth call him with king-queen suited.
Heads up here. Albert is called with queen jack of club. Excuse me. Eric is called with king queen suited. And Eric has got a pretty big hand here. Overcards and a speed draw. Now, Albert is going to continuation bet. He's got a gut shot to the nine with overcards.
Yeah, I'd like to see Eric raise this here, take a 10 right now.
Well, if you look at the stack, the guy seat number seven, Albert, I think he's got about 60 bucks up. I think all the money's going in here.
Yeah, and if you're Eric here, you move in. There's no way you're going to get away from it. What are you going to call here and then call the $60 on the turn? You might as well just put it all in right now.
Yep.
Good play by Eric.
And now, though, I mean, if you look at Albert's hand, well, he's going to call anyways.
And Albert's in terrible shape here. He needs a nine.
He's got a $400 pot here. Turn is a four. He could
or
get
jack.
The club now, too. Backdoor clubs.
Oh,
he gets backdoor
my.
Clubs. He's got a backdoor clubs. Unbelievable. That's
I
a
mean, he was in
beat.
Such bad shape.
Yeah.
When you look at that flop there.
Eric was a 4-1 favorite there.
I mean, he had, what, 3-9 outs? Because obviously the nine of spades is not an out.
Yeah.
And only two jack outs.
Yeah, that was,
and that was it. He literally had five outs in a turn.
Really
obviously,
bad.
Four clubs gives him nine more outs. That was awful.
It's almost as bad as queen nine against bottom set, dude. No, not quite. Not dealing with that type of money. $7,000 pot. Jeez. Button moves over here to seat four. Oh.
You know, it's funny also, we talk about overhead sometimes in Nolan and Hold'em, where there are some hands that are kind of unavoidable. You know, you lose set over set, you lose top two pair to a bottom set. And those are things, those kind of hands don't really upset me. Because you kind of go, that happens. There's going to be times where I'm going to have top set and somebody else is going to have bottom set. You know? The only thing I really get upset about sometimes is when I misplay something.
You know, I don't really get
something
upset
that's in,
with the
something
way the
I'm in control of, right. The cards I don't have control over. It was funny, I mean, being with my friends in Vegas, talking to them about poker, it's really interesting to get their perspective.
Well, John's it is. Now, yeah, John raised it with sixes. Good flop for him, but Reggie's open-ended here with an overcard.
Yeah, he's got backdoor spades as well.
John bet, and Reggie called.
Reggie's got a 2-1 dog here.
Turns a three. Sixes are still good here, Dave.
Yeah, and now, obviously, Reggie's hand gets much worse here because now the six that would have given him a straight four fills up John.
That's right.
So Reggie can only catch an ace or a queen to win this hand. Reggie's only got seven outs now to the win.
Reggie says he shouldn't be chasing.
And he's going to throw this away. And the river would have been the ace of spades, and Reggie would have gotten there, but it is a correct fold.
Yeah, Reggie would have made a wheel there. Probably should fold that pre-flop, queen, four, spades.
Right, I mean, once you call the flop, you're going to see the turn at least.
Right.
You're open-ended there. Board pairs, though, and your opponent keeps betting into you. Probably time to get away from
it. Yeah, but what I was talking about downtown Vegas, they do kind of have some unique food, like fried Twinkies and some other kind of, like, weirdish Vegas slash almost like carnival food.
It's cool,
like
I mean cakes, there's actually a restaurant in Four Queens that I went to a couple of years ago that was actually really good.
Yeah.
Can't remember it now.
I'm more into that.
I mean, it's their steak restaurant. It was actually pretty good.
And I think you can still find like the $4.95 prime rib dinner down there.
You can get that
in California or the Montana.
You can get that on the strip as well, though.
Yeah, can you?
Yeah. Pocket Kings in seat number nine.
Although I got to tell you, I mean, Vegas in years past used to have been everything was so cheap and the food was so cheap and the accommodations were so cheap because of the gaming. But now, I mean, there's a lot of expensive parts of Vegas.
Oh, yeah.
Seven-way action here. And Kings did not raise. Oh, he limped. And he did not get the limp re-raise
in
here.
There. And Calvin and John both have top pair. They might get themselves in trouble. Nobody else
and
has
Alan checked the Kings. And now John is going to bet. I mean, if you get yourself involved in a situation like this where you've limped in with an overpair and don't have the limp re-raise, Dave, your hand isn't good enough to check raise, right? Shouldn't you probably just bet and see where you're at?
Not usually.
I mean, he's going to check raise two people now in a limped pot?
The only thing you're thinking is now these people voluntarily entered the pot. Maybe they don't have two pair.
Now, look at this. We got a bet out by seat number one. Seat four called with king seven, and now Calvin is raised. And your king should go in the muck, even though their best hand here 100% of the time. But I don't think Alan's going anywhere. I think he thinks he's played it like a champion.
And he's looking to move all in.
A bet, a call, and a raise in an unraised pot, and he has check raised all in.
And this is often why you can't really judge the play by the result, because this is one of those where it's going to work.
Right.
And probably not the best way to play kings, though.
No. Oh, he's not even going to get called here.
Yeah. Now, it's funny. I was talking to my buddies who play poker, kind of recreational. They're playing
and
home games.
He shows the cards.
And a lot of them were bemoaning their bad luck. They'd be like, I had this, and I can't believe the guy stayed in there. Why did he stay in? Why did he do this? What a bad beat. And I was trying to explain to them, you want that. You know, if everybody that played against you was really good, you wouldn't make any money. And it's always funny when you start talking to people or people come up to me and talking about bad beat stories and everything. Because those never upset me. And I guess I stress that because I think our viewers also should go that way where you go, there are certain things you are in control of. The cards are not one of them. Okay, bad beats happen. You know, cold deck things happen. It's set over set, stuff like that. That happens.
Yeah, and you know, it's funny, there's a little discussion going on about the kajillionaires that are in the stands, and that's where I thought you were thinking about getting tickets. But, you know, maybe you can sit in the infield, because the infield of the Derby, according to J.B. Brent 33, is only a slight step up from the infield at a NASCAR race. Maybe those are the $250 seats, I don't know.
I'm going next year, just to spite you.
Raised here by seat number two, Reggie. And Al is called with Jack 4, and John's in there with 9-10 of clubs. And Reggie's going to bet. 50. Now, John's open-ended here from up front. Al has absolutely nothing. And it is a rainbow board here. He's out of position. Now, if John had some other straight draw, like 5-6 here, he'd actually be favored over Reggie's hand. But because they're sharing the 10, obviously John is a slight dog.
Right.
No pair versus no pair, but no pair with the draw is usually a favorite. And he is going to call.
I mean, still John is actually in.
Well, there's a 6, and he's got the nuts now.
Yeah, he's in pretty good shape now.
Right.
He's going to win at least half this pot.
And he checked it. Check right behind here by ace 10. And the river is a queen.
And now John's going to put money in there, and now Reggie's going to lay it down.
Well, you think Reggie's going to lay it down. And you can tell again how unbelievable, and this is another thing that I get on players too, and you know, John, he's played it pretty well tonight, but I see it in the higher games too. These guys bet so small on the river with a made hand. Yeah, you know, it almost forces you to call, like I said, you know, I actually didn't call with my queens there in that hand I gave you an example of.
Right.
But, you know, especially if the river is a low blank, you probably could bet so much more and get called for value. And you can almost get picked off the fact that you have a made hand when you bet so small, and they lose out on so much of value by playing the hands on that map.
Of course.
Checking it when they get there and betting so little. And I got to tell you, Filipino Tony, Dave, who we've seen plays the 1,000, he plays like that. It's unbelievable.
The funny thing is, he bets so small sometimes,
yeah,
begging for a call, you can almost lay down
right
a hand, even if you're getting 8 or 9 to 1
right
odds, because you know that you almost know exactly what he has, the way
right
he's played it.
Right.
Raise 50 more.
And Alan is going to raise here 50 more with pocket 10s.
Brian has played a pretty solid game all night long. Seat number 3. I mean, right now, it's always funny. People always ask, hey, who do you think is the best player at the bike? Consistently plays. You know, and obviously, it always depends on, you know, who's playing, what kind of game, which month it is. Obviously, it changes. It goes around. But right now, Brian in seat number 3, I mean, he's a real solid player so far.
And Brian's got ace king here in seat 3.
Raise, make it 25.
Seat number 2 here, Reggie has raised to
looks like $25.
Yeah.
Actually, Brian raised it up, sorry. So limping by Reggie, and Brian's raised it up with ace king. Now, Brian's played it pretty solid here. Do you really want to get involved?
Well, Albert's got king-queen offsuit. He's going to come in.
Well, we can see how much Broadway's out there. The likelihood is that nobody will hit their hands. We see there's only one queen left in the deck.
Yes.
And there's only two kings left in the deck.
So we got three-way action here, Dave.
Yeah, about an $80 pot. Well, What do I know? There's an ace and a king.
Let's see if Brian's going to come out and bet. There's a couple clubs out there, and he is. 50. Now, usually when you get up to the level of playing in a bigger game, the problems of somebody calling with weak aces aren't there. In this game, they're pretty prevalent. Now, not in this, you know, Brian's gotten unlucky in this case. Or just the problem of anybody calling with a dominated hand. Like, if that flop came king 3-7 with two clubs, I think Albert gets involved. I think he might still get involved now. I mean, it looks like he doesn't even want to lay the hand down.
Well, he's thinking about it. He really is, and he's in terrible shape. Now, it says 5%, but it's actually worse than that. Because there's only one queen left.
Right. But you know what I mean? Like, in a game like this, Dave, you often might find somebody who made the call with ace-10.
Right.
And gets all their chips in there with that.
Oh, definitely.
It's just, you know.
I mean, oftentimes, you've got to realize if the flop is ace-king-3, and let's say the 3 was actually a spade, okay, and not a club, and you're playing against a really, really solid player, and you're both very deep, even if you have ace-king, I mean, I'm not suggesting playing it passively and laying it down, but at the same time, you've got to be aware that if you're taking a lot of heat with that hand, what do you think they have?
Probably
ace-queen?
Tied.
Yeah, I mean, you probably have the same hand.
Or a set of threes. The great thing is bottom set, right?
Exactly.
Yeah.
I mean, you really got to start thinking about that because you're playing against a solid player. You're both very deep. Is he really going to keep pushing you at ace-queen or ace-jack?
Right.
Probably not. I mean, he's in check-call mode at best, and he probably lays it down.
Limp here by Brian under the gun with jacks. Now, I got to tell you, on this table, again, on a common 200 table, I think jacks are too good to limp in with. Maybe in a deeper game, in a 500 or 1,000 game. With a lot of people coming in with a lot of crap, I think you raise it with jacks. Just for value, you know?
I definitely agree. I mean, I got to tell you, I mean, jacks in a big game, I'll probably raise
right
70% of the time.
Eight-way action here. Limped around. Well, now Jax has got the overpair here, 9, deuce, 6 with a couple spades. And again, I mean, you might throw a – and Brian did not bet. You might throw a bet out there. See, oh, no, he did bet. Okay.
Yeah.
Might throw a bet out here, and you get called in a couple spots. You really got to reevaluate here. And even if you get raised here.
Well, you got to realize the blinds could have anything.
Right.
Anybody could be in there with deuce, 6.
Now, is Eric going to get involved with 8-9? Look how easily he folds 8-9. It's a good lay down.
Yeah. It's not the flop you're looking for with 8-9.
Brian takes it down. Email here from Dave Jones. Dave, from some of the emails that this guy sent us, I wonder how old this guy is. I mean, he is using a computer, so you have to give him some credit.
But he says,
if you want to PO a hardcore, if you want to piss off a hardcore handicapper, say something about the Derby. He'll shoot back which Derby? The first was the Epsom Derby in England, named after Edward Smith Stanley, the 12th Earl of the Derby. There are many derbies every year in the U.S. And derbies are races for three-year-olds. That's how they're defined. But none has had the marketing hype that the Kentucky Derby has had. So there you go.
Well, you learn something new every day.
Look at this. Brian's got pocket kings now.
Now, he just won last pot. You wonder if sometimes you can use that to your advantage. People kind of think maybe this guy's full of it a little bit when they raise two hands in a row.
He didn't raise, though. Remember,
but
he limped.
I'm just thinking that. I assume he's going to raise this one.
Well, especially if he's limped around now and he's got kings and the big one. And I've seen it now a couple of times.
Now, if you're Calvin, how much did he raise? If you're Calvin, it's an easy call.
25 more.
It is an easy call if you're Calvin.
With a guy like that, well, I guess you really value. I was going to say, if you got a deep stack in there, you might want to raise it more, but maybe you just decide not to get mixed up with this guy in seat 5 if he continues on big with the hand. Here we go. Four-way action. Queen 6-3 here, and Brian's just take this one down again.
Yeah, I'm sure he'll put a little continuation bet there and take it down. Now, you wonder, though, the flop's got queen 6 deuce instead. Calvin is real deep, and so is Brian. You wonder how big this pot would have gotten.
Well, I got to tell you, what probably would happen was Brian would probably bet the flop, and Calvin would call. The turn, whatever that would come, even if it was a blank, when Brian went to bet again and Calvin raised him, I think Brian's probably a good enough player where he would have gotten away from it, knowing that the guy's raised on the turn. Usually indicative of a big hand, as opposed to raising him right away on the flop.
Might have been, yeah.
And building a pot up. Interesting email that Dave Jones sent us a couple of days ago regarding that hand with Corporation Mike when he misread his hand with deuce 3. He was talking about how when he played stud, the old timers in poker might have actually given the money back, because in stud, if you made a call on 7th Street and your board couldn't beat your opponent's board, it would be common courtesy and etiquette to give the money back to the caller, because they obviously misread their hand. And I've actually looked at a couple of emails over the weekend and over the last few days asking, legitimately asking, did Jay give the money back to Mike because he misread his hand? I've never heard that, but, you know, it's...
See, the problem in Hold'em is it's a little different in stud in the sense that there's a call on 5th Street, a call on 6th Street. It's not no limit.
Right.
Generally, it's a limit game. And on 7th Street, when they say they give the money back, they just give the 7th Street money back.
Right.
But the problem is, now what happens if Mike, who had misread his hand, got Jay off the hand? You know what I mean?
Reggie here. Reggie has got an open-ended straight flush draw, and he is going to bet 20. And I'll get to what you just said here in a second. Now, look at that. Brian is not even going to get involved with ace 3.
Yeah, I like it lay down.
Now, is Calvin going to call with 4 or 5? He does. Reggie could catch a heart here. He could catch a 9. He could catch a 3. And Allen's in there with the bottom end of the straight draw, 3-4. And Reggie's made the pure nuts.
Yeah, unfortunately for Allen, he's made a pair here. Now, Calvin has made 2 pair. And is Reggie going to double up here?
Calvin bets 75.
And this is the time, I'm not sure how deep Reggie is. How deep is Reggie?
Looks like he might only have 150 left. I think it's an easy move-in. It's only 75 more.
You only have 150, it's an easy move-in. And look at this.
Oh, Allen's not going to get involved here with 3-4, is he?
Really? He's open-ended? No, okay.
All right. And Reggie should probably push here.
Now, if you had a little bit more money, let's say you had, say, $600 or $700, you might just mini-raise or maybe make it 225, build yourself a pot so you can bet the river big.
He moves in, and a call here by Calvin. And that is the nuts. Yeah, that is the hand that you want, especially with 7-8 of hearts. You actually want that offsuit 4 to come. Nice.
Yeah, the 4, actually, I don't mind a 9 also. Sometimes a 9 can be a little confusing to people.
Right. Offsuit 9 or the 4. Now, to make the case for that, though, is someone could say, well, Jay could give the amount of money back that Mike called after he moved in on the turn.
Okay.
That's what I mean by
there
that.
There you go. Okay.
Not the whole pot, but...
That would be the only amount, obviously.
Right.
And that actual amount was only, by the way, that was only another, like, $1,100.
Yeah, I don't remember exactly specifically what
I mean, during the entire hand, I think that Mike lost about $4,000. But the actual call on the river with 3 high was only $1,100.
The call of all in.
Yeah.
Pretty incredible.
I mean, because you can imagine Mike turning it over going, oh, my God, I thought I had a 4. Well, I was bluffing, so here's your money back.
Right.
Yeah, okay.
See, number 6 is going to raise here. 10-8 off suit. And the button here is call with pocket 4s. So again, Jonathan here raising with kind of an inferior hand from up front. Brian is call with 4s here. And here we go to the flop. Well, king 9-8.
Well, this is a problem now. I mean, a good player has called you on the button, and you have bottom pair, and now you're forced to commit more chips. Now, in this case, it's obviously going to work. But if Brian, say, had ace-king or a set or something like that, Brian can really play it tricky in position, and you'll have no idea where you're at.
We're already halfway through the show here.
Yeah.
Got an hour and a half left.
Jonathan shows him an 8. And that actually makes you wonder here. Jonathan actually looked at both cards, took the 8 and showed it to him, which makes you think, what the heck were you raising with under the gun?
I don't quite understand.
I mean, it's funny. Jonathan was almost trying to make it look like he was legit. But once he shows the 8, it almost takes it away. What language am I speaking tonight?
Man. I don't know. I've always wondered.
Speaking Vegas tonight.
Button moves over here to seat 4. So you did get to play a little bit of that WPT game that we talked about.
I played that, a little blackjack.
I can't wait to play that game.
I love playing craps. I played a little craps.
15.
Drank way too much.
C2 is going to raise here with ace 7 of clubs. Mostly beer.
45. Awesome.
And Calvin is going to re-raise here with jacks.
Actually.
He's going to re-raise here with jacks.
It was Cinco de Mayo. I continued with the tequila, little Patron.
Patronus. Raise and a re-raise here, and Allen is not deep enough to make this call.
No, that's the problem.
Bucks.
Just doesn't have enough money.
$45 with 4-5 suited here.
He's putting in, what, 20% of his stack?
Well, maybe he's got more like 400. He's going to make the call. Looks like that stack in front's kind of dirty, dude.
Okay, so still, so he's putting in 10% of
the
stack. That's still too much money for 4-5 suited there.
And Reggie is going to call from behind with ace-seven of clubs here. Again, we talked about that hand having needing extreme implied odds.
Now, okay.
6-7-9 here.
What's Alan going to do here with 4-5? Oh, he's open-ended.
Calvin's got the overpair. And Calvin's going to bet 200, which means now for Alan there is no fold equity to go over the top.
No.
This guy's screaming overpair here, right?
Of course. Well, if he has an overpair and you don't put him on an 8, can you call this with the open-ended straight draw? The pot is now $120.
No, it's $320, $120 to call. No, you can't. The two flush out there,
no,
you got a guy
yeah,
behind.
Oh, I forgot, for some reason, I keep thinking seat 9 is short, but still has, like you said, $300 or so. And Alan is actually tortured by this. I mean, it's one of the problems of the 4-5 suited. Sometimes one mistake begets another mistake. He's open-ended here. Obviously, the 8 is not a valuable card there. It would be a one-liner to anybody have a 10. I mean, if Calvin had pocket 10s here, and Alan finally throws it away, and Reggie, I can't imagine Reggie getting involved
Reggie's
here.
Got second pair here with an overcard. We've seen him call with a lot less.
Yeah, I mean, he's a 3-to-1
but
dog.
Remember, yeah, you're right. It is a $200 bet here.
Yeah, I don't think he's going to commit all his chips here. He's going to throw this away. He shows it and throws it away. And Calvin takes it down with the jacks and shows the jacks.
So what was like the action like over at Bellagio? I mean, they had a couple 30-60 games. I know they do 15-30, then 30-60 limit, and then what were the no limit games?
Yeah, the poker room actually wasn't really. I mean, obviously the whole place was crowded, but the poker room wasn't packed.
Well, they've got
two events
going on at the circuit event and at, what is that, Mirage and Caesars?
Mirage has got the World Poker Tour.
Yeah.
And Caesars has got the circuit.
Right.
So I think most of the action was there.
So was there like one 10-20 no limit game or something?
Two 10-20 no limit games.
Yeah.
They had like one 5-10 no limit game. Now, their 5-10 no limit game.
Yeah, what's the rules?
It's a $400 to 1,000 you can buy.
Oh, okay.
It's not a terrible game.
Yeah.
I actually played that for a second while I was waiting to get my 4-8 limit game.
But 10-20 is uncapped, right?
10-20 is uncapped, yes.
$30 raise here by seat 5. And how much money was kind of on the table there?
It ranged anywhere from, say, like 800, which was the minimum buy-in. A couple of people had $800, and then some people had as much as 9,000.
Call here by Alan with Jack 10. Well, ace king 4 here. Let's see if Calvin can use his position to bet. Anyway, check. Turns a 10, and now Alan's backed in the best hand here with Jack 10. Check again. And the river's a queen, and now Alan's backed into a straight.
Is Alan going to bet it now? No, Calvin's going to bet it now.
Alan checked? Are you kidding me? No, I don't think it's not yet, dude.
But look at this. Okay, go to Calvin. Look at get a shot of Calvin here. Look at Calvin. He's got chips in his hand like he's ready to call. He actually took those off his stack.
Well, there's nothing he can beat.
He wasn't holding any chips until the river.
Wow.
And now he grabs some chips as if I'm going to call you.
Alan bets 50.
Yeah, there wasn't, like I said, there wasn't a lot of action going on at the Bellagio this weekend. Bobby's room was actually empty the whole weekend while I was there.
Right, which is where the high limit game usually goes on, right?
And that was completely empty.
Well, you wouldn't really expect. Well, I mean, actually, with everybody there in Vegas, you know, they might be comfortable with playing.
Well, that's the thing I was confused about. During the World Series last year, a lot of people would play the tournaments over at Rio and then head over to Bellagio play.
Right.
And I thought the action at Bellagio would be better. But like I said, I really wasn't there to play poker.
What'd you think about the high brush over there?
The high what?
Brush.
What's the high brush?
the you know, kind of like the floor men, the way that they worked the games. High brush, like the floor men, the floor staff.
The floor staff.
Yeah, yeah.
I think they did an okay job.
Yeah.
I'm sorry, I never heard of high brush.
Really?
No, never. That's the first. I'm learning all sorts of things. I didn't know, you know, the whole derby thing that Dave Jones sent. Brand new to me.
Limped around.
High brush, brand new.
Three
I know
ways.
I got to get with it. I'm sorry.
7-deuce-7 here on the flop. Missed everyone. Well, we got a 6-deuce over here for seat two.
Well, Eric's got him out kicked then. Eric's got 9-deuce.
Ah. Well, Reggie's going to come out and bet on the deuce. Is Eric really going to get involved? Eric was up front. He checked up. Yeah, Eric's
he's going to get involved.
No way. And again, normally, I got to say probably, it literally is, Dave, 80 to 90% of the people that are going to come out and bet that flop do not have a 7 if they're playing at this
level. Of course, yeah. Most players, you're 100% correct.
Yeah.
Yeah, actually, the floor staff at Bellagio does a pretty good job. I like them. I really do. I think they, when I was there over last summer and I played there on a regular basis, I got a nice rapport with them, and they really took care of me. And then this time when I was there with all my buddies, we wanted to play together. Mm-hmm. And they arranged it as soon as they could. Get
you
a chip count here?
You know, one of the floor ladies at the win, I'll get to that in a second.
Yeah, $5,400 on the table. Calvin up to $1,900. Now Brian at $1,200. He's really had a nice showing so far. Al bringing up the rear. He's only got $120. Let's see how they're doing. Brian up $785 since the show started. Wow. Pretty good showing there. Calvin is up 20. Al, the big loser so far. He's down 315. And we'll keep track of that all night.
A three-way action here. Limped around. 10-8-3 here with a couple of spades. And it's missed everybody. Turns to king. Checked around again. And the river is an ace. And now Calvin has the best hand. And he's going to bet 15 here, and he's going to take it down. One of the floor ladies over at the Wynn, Dave, used to deal here. Nice, pretty little Asian lady. I don't remember her name. She used to be a dealer here at the bike. I mean, the Wynn is really not that big of a card room.
No, it wasn't big at all.
Have you checked out the, what is it, the Porsche? The Porsche?
Oh, the like Lamborghini.
Yeah.
That. Every time I'm there, it's always closed. I was kind of hoping I'd win a few million dollars and, you know, drive back in one, but alas, it didn't happen.
Supposedly there was a story about a guy that literally wanted to buy. I mean, that's why I think they charged admission, because a lot of people were just there to look. Wanted to buy, and they wouldn't, like, let him cut the line. Like, he wanted to cut the line and go in and buy, and they wouldn't let him do it. They booted him in the back of the line, and then he left.
Are you kidding?
Yeah, I heard this, like, a couple months back. I read this somewhere. Yeah, I was like, are you serious?
Interesting. Email here from James Gelfer. I want to get to it in a second.
Go raise here by seat number 4, Al. He's got pocket 10s. He's going to bring it in for 20. See if Reggie's going to play. He's got 7s here, Dave. He's probably gonna call.
Problem is that Al doesn't have any money here.
Oh, yeah, you're right. Al doesn't have any money.
I mean, you've got to think your head here.
Well,
you
I think he's going to move in. No, he just calls. I don't really understand that. But. I mean, what is he going to do? Just fold here?
Right. I mean,
ace, six, nine. Well, there's an ace on board. Is he
terrible
just
flop
fold?
For sevens here. Yeah. What are you going to do? Check and call?
No, he's going to move in.
Okay.
51.
And Al calls.
Well, now he needs a 7 and only a 7.
Yeah, running clubs are no good because Al's got the 10 of clubs.
Down to 2 outs. Not going to get there.
Yeah.
Now, James Gelfer was referring to the Jason play where he said, hey, giving money back to Mike. And he said, hey, what if Mike hit a deuce or a 3 on the river? Would he give the money back? I don't think so. And obviously, you were talking about after he calls, it was very obvious that Mike had misread his hand.
Right.
Now, would you give the money back?
No,
I wouldn't.
And I've done things in the past where, like, somebody's actually accidentally exposed the card and I have stopped betting when I knew he was drawing dead. But in that particular case, no.
You would not.
But I'm pretty. I do a lot of etiquette things at the table, and I'm not one that's always going to cheat, or it's going to cheat someone just to win money. But in that case, I don't really think it's an etiquette. Maybe I'm just too much of a hold'em player.
Yeah, it's funny. In some cases, I'll do it. I mean, I was actually playing deuce to 7 triple draw at one point.
Yeah.
And I was playing with a couple of guys, and one guy who had never played before, but was nice enough to go, hey, I'll give it a shot. What the heck? We're playing 10-20 mix.
That's a little bit different.
Yeah. Well, anyway, here, I've got ace-king versus tens, and I'll tell the story in a second.
Wow. Two pairs of tens. And Eric has raised it to 25 here with his tens.
Well, you got to like Reggie's hand here in the sense that he's getting 2-1 against the same pair. And there's the king.
Yep.
And Reggie's got this hand locked up. He cannot lose it.
Check.
I mean, I suppose it could come out 7-8. Runner.
And Eric is going to bet 75, and I assume that Reggie is probably, what, going to check raise him? Or at least call. Now, Alan is really struggling with this one. Again, I mean, you wonder if these guys are paying attention to
Eric,
the player that they're playing against. I guess the simple answer there is no, right? As I see, Pajato makes an appearance on the board.
He says there he is.
Usually gets paid off because no one's ever paying attention to how tight he plays.
Right.
And Reggie is going to check raise all in here.
Yeah, and this is an easy lay down for Alan. You got to look at that board now. There's really no draw up there. I mean, somebody could have 7-8, but probably not likely in a raised pot.
Yeah, he's only getting probably 2-1 in the pot. Look at this. Reggie's telling him what he has, Dave, which is always nice.
And he shows the tens.
And he shows the ace king.
Shows the line.
So anyways, go to the...
Also, I was going to say, anyway, I'm playing deuce 7 triple draw with a couple of guys, one who had never played before but said, okay, I'll give it a shot. We're playing 10-20, mixed game. And... he made a hand and he was betting the entire way, like really strong, like he had a big hand. And I ended up making like an 8-5, okay? Just a pretty good hand. I had like 8-5, 4-3. I mean, it was like 8
right.
Perfect, okay? And I ended up like, it was almost like a crying call on the river. And he turned over and he showed me an ace. Okay? And he showed like a 6-4-3 deuce ace, okay? And I was like, oh. And
we're
I actually.
Not playing low ball, right?
And I actually split the pot with him.
Okay.
And I gave it back to him. Because he, you know, he was giving the game a
right,
shot. He didn't
right.
know.
That's a little bit different, though.
Same thing happened with Padugi, where a guy thought, didn't realize the board, he had a paired. He had four different suits, but he had paired his four. And that happens sometimes, too. And, you know.
Calvin is raised here with king-queen. All right, how about this? Are you going to give money back to Mike in that situation?
Mike? I'm thinking about it. You know, on Friday, I definitely said no way. I mean, I'm sorry, what was it, Wednesday?
Yeah.
On Wednesday, I had said there's no way I give him the money back. And the more I think about it, after seeing it, man.
Remember, he check-raised him on the turn.
No, I'm not getting there's no way I give him any of that money
and
back.
And then
I might give
him moved all in, and then Jay moved in.
I might give Mike the called money back.
Yeah.
Just a call on the river. There's no way I'm giving him the check raise back. I might just give him the call back. It's funny, sometimes a little bit
I mean, I think
of
you're mixing apples and oranges. You're talking about a guy who's helping the 10-20 mix game out and never played Badoogie and deuced to 7.
No, definitely. Clearly, obviously, you're not going to sit there and go, come on, Mike, you know how to play. Obviously, this isn't your first day playing. I mean, the pot ended up being about $8,000. I mean, 69 of which I'm going to take no matter what. The last 1,100... If it's a player that I know really well, that I'm friendly with, you know, that I know is going to continue giving action, it might go a long way to give him the 1,100 back. Who knows?
Calvin's going to raise it out of the blind here. He's going to make it 40 more. He's got pocket jacks. And Reggie is going to call here, Dave. Jack, six of clubs. He's in horrible shape.
Yeah, some players really love those suited cards, no matter what they are.
Now, Brian had limped in with ace, five of diamonds. Now, he is super deep, and so is Calvin. But again, ace, rag, wheel card suited. You got to hit just right.
I got to tell you, though, in a case like that where I'm that deep, I might just call.
King 10 4 here. Well, against competition, normal competition in this game, you got to figure if you make aces up and a guy has ace king, you're going to probably win a lot, right?
Who knows? I mean, I can make aces up. I can make diamonds. I'm also on the button. Now, if I'm out of position, there's no way I call
right.
there. But I'm on the button with ace 5 there. So if by chance I flop a diamond draw, I might be able to manipulate the betting and even get a free card. Who knows?
Right.
I probably call that with those two stacks. But obviously, like you always say, you've got to be real deep to make that call.
Butt moves over here to seat four. Pocket aces here for Albert. Now he's playing pretty tight here since he's gotten to the table.
And he's not going to do the limp re-race. He's going to bet right out. He's going to bet strong.
He's going to make it 45. And you know what? Why not raise to 45 when you get called by a guy who's got ace three of diamonds? We're just talking about how deep you need to be to make that call, specifically probably on the button and see number nine.
Right, on the button, and you've got,
$1,000 deep, basically.
Yeah, you're 25 times deep.
Right.
25
right.
times the blind there.
Yeah.
The bet, that is. And Calvin makes a nice easy lay down there. He lays down King Jack. Now, obviously, it's an easy lay down, but we often see players at this level making that mistake, calling with a hand that can be dominated.
And Albert's over 90% against this guy. Well, Alan's got a wheel draw and diamonds. Now, this is a hand where if I was deep and I had called with ace three and the guy put a flimsy bet out on the flop, I might call in position. Remember, I've got a straight draw and backdoor diamonds. Now, he's bet 100 here. I mean, he shouldn't even have bet in there pre-flop.
Right, that's definitely not a flimsy bet.
No.
Now, the only thing you wonder here, I really like the lay down by Calvin. King Jacks, offsuit, pre-flop. We see a lot of times players getting involved with a hand like that, and then you see a flop like this, and they end up going broke.
Now, what I mean by either a flimsy bet, say a guy in the blind raised me, and I call with ace three of diamonds on the button, and say the flop comes king, deuce four, and he flops a set of kings, and he either checked it to me, or he bet real weak, I definitely would check behind him or might call thinking I might take it away from him and king. And look at this, the rabbit actually in the turn showed a five.
There you go.
And if a guy plays a set of kings cagey there and I just check right behind him, and then maybe I pick up a diamond draw. And remember, the pot has stayed so small that I can actually call the turn. And now my gin card is the offsuit five on the river. Because how on the earth can
not
put
diamond,
me on that?
But it's the offsuit five.
Right.
Yeah, oftentimes people try to play it cagey, and they think, well, I'll check raise him with my monster.
Right.
And instead you go, okay, the guy wants to give me a free card, I'll take it.
Right.
We always say no limit hold'em. It's kind of a game of mistakes. The best players will capitalize on those mistakes and obviously make less mistakes than the bad ones. Good to see our potato on the 2+2 board.
It's a little bit of a slow time here at the casino, Dave, because we're kind of in between tournaments.
Yeah, our next tournament actually doesn't start till May 20th, I believe. Right around there. King Jack 6 out there. And Jonathan's got top pair. Not a great flop for King Nine of Diamonds, but he is in the lead right now.
25.
And Reggie, he's betting $25 with Jack 8. He's got second pair. Backdoor flush draw. And if you're Jonathan, you get involved. Well, Jonathan's going to call.
Looks like it's just a check crying call here, Dave.
Two players.
And we're heads up.
Turn is an eight, and look at that. Reggie makes two pair.
Yep.
And if you're Reggie, you continue betting here. And look at Reggie. Reggie wanted to put all that money in right away. Kind of pulled back for a second. He looked like he wanted to shove it in there.
Jack eight? Good enough to check here on the turn?
I don't think he was thinking of checking. He was going to move all in right away, and now he said, you know what? Wait a second. I don't got to put all my money in there. Maybe I can get called by a king.
And he's going to bet.
Now, this is one of those times that Jonathan was ahead, but he got no information on the flop. He didn't bet out his king nine. He just checked called. And now he's put in a spot where he doesn't even know, is Reggie betting queen 10? Is Reggie betting clubs? Or does Reggie have me beat already? Did he get there? Really, you have no idea where you're at now with King 9. Reggie's being honest with him, though. He's telling him he's got it.
And Jonathan's really struggling with this one. I mean, the guy is fired twice. Well, not quite, Jonathan.
Sure.
You know, it's funny. I was looking at something a guy has in the river as a 10 here, which would not have helped. Guy has sent me something on MySpace, some embedded.
I want to say that's the 78 World Series.
Yeah. They did that World Series outside.
Yeah.
Against Stu Younger. And
they had a couple of them outside, I think, yeah. I want to say. I think it was to accommodate the crowds, I would assume.
I don't think this was 78, because ESPN wasn't even around in 78, were they? Didn't they do it? Did you want it 97, right?
Is that his 97 year?
I think it is.
Oh, that is his 97 year. I'm sorry. You're right.
Yeah. It's funny how we couldn't actually tell by looking at the players.
It was so grainy.
Their dress and their look is probably the same as 1978, 1997.
Well, look at Stewie. I mean, the funny thing is, in 1978, he actually looked like he was 12. In 97, he looked like he was 25.
Yeah. Live straddle here by seat 9. John has limped in with a jack, 10 of diamonds. And it's going to get limped around here, and we're going to see through reaction. Queen 8-9 with a couple of spades.
Nice flop for seat number 1. He flops the nuts.
25.
And he's going to bet the nuts.
Yeah, he's going to bet 25 here.
And
Jonathan is going to call.
Wow.
And again, you talk about, look at how betting here makes money in the hand.
And the amazing thing is, and why not bet now? Now you bet 50. You don't have to bet a lot. Just keep him in the pot. Well,
building a pot, you probably get called by a queen, and then you build up a pot so much that you can bet 100 or 150 on the river.
Exactly.
Well, hope the guy backs him in 2 pair. You know, it's funny, this little thing that this guy sent me on MySpace is through YouTube. Is there a way that we can get clips of Live at the Bike at YouTube, or would that, like, be gnarly because of the digital rights management on the archives thing? Anyone? That'd be cool to see, like, a couple clips from Live at the Bike. If anyone can do that, put it up on YouTube. That would be cool. Unless, do it. Yeah, but what can somebody independently put, like, a clip up on YouTube? Uh-huh.
Interesting. Ace-jack for seat number 7 on the button. Now, seat number 4 has raised it up. He's raised it up with jack-10 offsuit. Gets a call from Calvin. And gets called by the button with ace-jack. Now, Eric's going to play with king-9. Alan is not going to play a 7 deuce. And we're going to see this 5 ways, about a $100 pot. Flop is ace, 10, deuce. And
Reggie and Albert both have top pair.
Now, is Reggie going to get himself involved?
Oh, he's going to come out and bet right away here, Dave.
I don't mind the bet. He's going to put a little feeler bet out there, see where he's at. Now, you got to realize the board is not draw heavy. There's no straight draw out there. There's no flush draw out there. If you get called, you're probably behind.
Calvin is going to call with queen 10. Well, and now for Albert, I mean, the board is really not that draw heavy. It wouldn't be out of the realm of, you know, possibility. I forget who raised it pre-flop here.
It actually was seat number 4 who folded already.
I mean, do you overcall here with ace-jack? I don't like calling that hand to a raise anyways. You got a bet from early position into a razor, Dave, and now a guy who calls in between.
Well, he's going to get the call here.
Yeah.
And this pot is quickly $280.
And it turns
and there's
a
jack.
And that gives Albert aces up now.
Now, if you're Reggie, you got to know your beat here, right? You bet your ace 9, you got called in 2 spots.
And this guy's going to move immediately for 200.
Yeah, and he bets 200 into a $280 pot. $480 pot now. 280 to 200 to call. And this is a pretty easy fold if you're ace 9, isn't it?
Yeah.
I mean, you still got Calvin between you.
I think you know if you had ace-jack, even if the jack didn't come there, that you're good. What I mean by that is, yeah, the jack gives you 2 pair, but if Reggie had ace-king or ace-queen, wouldn't he keep firing even with the jack there on the turn?
Probably.
I mean, I think you probably can deduce that your hand was best on the flop now.
Yeah.
Even though that turn card strengthens your hand, unless for some reason somebody's sandbagging king-queen.
And Reggie's actually drawing dead. He cannot win this hand.
Yeah. That's all it is. Well, he's bet 200. He's got about $75 left.
Yeah, and Reggie's got to realize here.
Remember, Reggie got mixed up with ace deuce at the beginning of the show, Dave.
Yeah, and you got to realize just top pair, no kicker. And he's going to throw it away. You know what? He learned his lesson from the ace deuce. Nice lay down by Reggie. And I like the way he played the hand. He bet his ace 9 right away. Maybe figuring somebody had queens or kings. Maybe he can get him off that and win it. When he gets called in 2 spots, he checks and folds. No problem with that.
You check.
Got about 45 minutes left in our show. You can catch Live at the Bike every Monday through Friday from 7 to 10 Pacific time. Tomorrow night's kind of a special event. We're going to have a $200 no-limit hold'em game. So it's not our normal 3 to 5 game. You can catch Wednesday's game, which is going to be our whale game. We have 25, 50 blinds, $3,000 minimum buy-in, no max.
We are all the way up to 714 friends on MySpace here.
That is
great. Live at the bike page. And my girl, Liz Lou, she keeps getting knocked down in our top eight. Who the hell is doing that? $30 raise here by seat two. Ace 10 of hearts here.
And he's going to take it down.
Yep.
So who are our best eight friends here? You, of course.
Me, surely. The circuit.
Scott Hoff's up. That was good. That is so good, Isaac. That is so good, man. That's just key. Great job there. Bart still has no idea.
No, I saw.
You did? Okay. Yeah. The circuit, Poker Radio. You got the Grinder, Liz Lou, Genocide.
Chris and Daniel Negrano. I think we should actually take those, the two of those at the end out, because I think they're just kind of like promotional gimmicks. Gimmicky accounts. It's weird. All of a sudden, I just got a case of the hiccups. I wasn't even eating anything.
This is hysterical. Pocket aces here for Al. And Reggie's going to call him a 9-7 suited. We're going to see this heads up. And not a real good flop for 9-7 suited.
He's got a gut shot to the 8.
Al's going to bet it, and Reggie, you imagine, is going to throw this away.
Reggie bets 25.
Actually, Al bets that 25.
Excuse me. Yeah, Al bets 25. There were two red aces.
Now, Reggie can call 9-7 suited if he's real deep and the guy's playing against is real deep. The problem is, those, Reggie's not that deep, and Al's got no money.
And he's out of position. The best reason why you wouldn't call there is because Al has got about $50 left. I mean, how can you possibly call $20?
I mean, there's almost a checklist that has to go through your head when you start thinking of, should I call a hand somewhat like a speculative hand, like a small pocket pair, or say a one gap connector, a suited connector, or something like that. You got it. The checklist is kind of like, okay, am I in a position, out of position? Number two, does the player I'm playing against have a lot of money? Do I have a lot of money? You might want to look at, is the player I'm playing against good enough to get away from a hand, or is he going to pay me off? All these things have to go in your mind. Why aren't I one of the friends?
You don't have a MySpace account.
All right, that's it. I got to make one, don't I?
Hey, I was, like I said, over the weekend, I was trying to figure out how you do pictures and stuff on MySpace. You need to know HTML code, all that kind of stuff. My God. I'm sure it's not that difficult. Five-way action here.
Well, there's the ace.
Yep. Ace, jack.
Oh, two pair for seat number three. Brian's got deuce three.
Yeah, he's got bottom two pair.
Let's see how he plays it. He is in first position now. He's checked deuce three. I got to tell you, that is a dangerous check.
Well, Albert's going to bet with ace jack.
He is checked two pair there. I got to tell you how I like to play deuce three there. I'll probably bet right into it. If I get raised, I can re-raise strong.
Well, he's going to check raise. Now, Albert has played well, and obviously Brian, we've talked about how he has played well. I think Albert should be able to get away from this if he's been paying attention to the game.
You've got to realize that.
I mean, there's no way Brian is check-raising this flop without ace-jack being beat here. Maybe he does it with ace-queen. Maybe he does it with ace-king.
Yeah.
I can't imagine he would do it with ace-jack. Turns a queen.
Well, the queen doesn't change anything. If your opponent had ace-queen, he already had you beat.
And now Brian's moved in.
He moved all in.
And you're right. It didn't matter here
no,
for Albert.
No, it doesn't change anything. And Albert calls
Albert
here.
Albert calls for like 400.
And Albert needs an ace, a queen, or a jack.
This pot is $800 here. Over 800. I'm really surprised that Albert has committed all that money with just ace jack on a pot that was in essence pretty much limped around. And actually, it was Brian that bet, and Albert moved in, and Brian called.
Yeah.
So.
Wow, he just saw that he was betting, and he moved all in.
Brian bet. Albert moved in.
And Albert's got two aces to catch. I'm not really scared of the He can catch three, one of the three queens left, or one of the three jacks. He's got eight outs to the win here.
He calls.
And that's it.
Well, and Brian actually has now called, so he took a little bit of time, and he called. And the river is a deuce, and Brian fills up here.
I was going to say the board needs the pair, but it can't be a deuce or a three. And just like that, Brian is by far our big winner in this show.
Could you ever think that, and I don't know if Albert was intending to do that, but would you ever think that a really advanced play would actually be for Albert to maybe try to use that queen as a scare card if Brian had been check raising with ace king again, you don't really see that type of
no, definitely. But I think the funny thing is that seat number three, Brian was putting money in the pot already. He check raised you. I just don't know if you have enough money to get him off that pot, that hand at all.
Yeah.
You've got to realize at that point the pot's already $700-$800 and you're betting 200 more. Okay, I'm getting 4-1 and I've got two pair. Where do you want me to go?
Got an email here from Alex saying that he was playing the 200 no limit game on Friday. And he ended up winning about 500 for a 6-hour session. He was wondering if that was a typical big win or a modest win.
That's a pretty good win.
Yeah, that is a pretty good win.
I mean, you're only buying it for $200, and you've now won 500, so you've turned 200 into 700.
Yeah, remember,
good
too,
game.
I mean, the rake in this game, I think, is killer. Because if
yeah,
you sit there and just fold, and win a couple pots, you know, you've got to beat the rake at a pretty good rate, too.
Big line raised 20.
Anytime you can more than double your money, you're doing real well.
And Al here is a little bit, we see this a lot, he's raised to 20, Dave. He has $80 left. He's raised to 20 with ace 6 suited here. And he gets called in two spots.
Wow, what a flop for 8-10, huh?
No, not quite. He's got a pair and a gut shot.
Oh, for a second, I thought that was a straight. I thought the 10 was a 9.
But now, Al checks. Jonathan bets with the nut flush draw. Reggie calls with 8-10 backdoor diamonds, middle pair, and a gut shot to the 9. And Al has kind of opened himself into a world of hurt here by raising with ace 6.
Oh, he's got nothing here. Throw it away.
There's two players.
And we're heads up here. Well, the turn's a 5. Reggie is still good here. Well, let's see if Jonathan's going to continue to fire here. Maybe throw a little stop bet out there, Dave?
I think that's exactly what you do here.
Well, he's going to fire big. Semi-bluff, big, or stop bet. I guess there's two ways of looking at
100.
It.
100.
And he's going to bet 100.
You've got to think this fold equity here. I mean, Reggie's only got second pair, no kicker.
Now, again, we talk about the nut flush draw not necessarily being a dry flush draw because of the fact if you have the ace high nut draw, you also have an over.
And look at that, the ace of spades on the river.
So you would have paired up on the river there.
Jonathan actually had 12 outs there.
And Michael Shepard has emailed us asking about, what the hell is Badoogie? And also, what is Mexican poker? You know, is the Bicycle Casino really the only place that really spreads Mexican poker around? I think it is. I don't think that there are other casinos.
Other casinos try to, but nobody does as well.
Mexican poker is a variation of five-card stud.
Yeah, with a joker.
There's one joker in the deck, and I think it's the sevens, eights, and nines are pulled out of the deck. So a straight is actually made. You can have a 5-6, 5-6-10 jack queen, king straight, or whatever five cards is. 8, 9s, and 10s. Okay, that's what it is.
Bob, I raised 20.
And there's kind of a system of revealing one card and then hiding another card.
We'll get to that in a second here. Al is raised with ace king. He's made it 20. Now he's raised here again, this time with ace king.
And Alan's going to give him a little action here with 4-5 diamonds.
Now, if you're playing short stack in this game and you've got 65 left and you've got 5 limpers, I'd probably just move in with ace king.
I think
small
so.
Line.
I mean, unless you want to do the old stop and go. Wow.
And he flopped the full house here. And he checks. And Alan checks behind him. Now, Alan shouldn't call there because Al has no money.
Right.
Turns a 10.
And if there's ever a time to slow play, I don't mind this slow play in the sense that, you know.
Well, remember, not with these stack sizes.
That's the whole thing. I mean, seat number 4 has got no money.
Yeah.
So.
Check call here to 20.
You don't
six.
Need to build a pot. I might even check this one more time.
And now he's going to bet. He's going to bet 25. And I think that he probably would have got a check behind him there. But anyways, Mexican poker, yeah. 8, 9s, and 10s are taken out, so you can make straights in those weird combinations. You can use a joker, and basically it's five-card stud, but you get one card up and one card down. And then you have the option of revealing your down card and getting the next card down, or keeping your down card and getting the next card up.
Now,
and so on and so on in every street.
And I believe if they give you a joker...
And it's down, and it's wild.
Right, and if it's up, it's not, which is why you're always seeing the next person's card.
Yeah, if it's up, it's... Just an ace and a complete straights and flushes, which is normally why someone will always choose to expose their down card so they can get the next card down.
Right.
Because if they don't have the joker. And it is an action game.
Oh, big action game. We actually built a whole new section for Mexican poker.
five-way action here.
Over in the middle of the casino. It's really nice.
9-6 deuce here, a couple of diamonds. Two people have got diamond draws here. Brian and Calvin.
We actually have over 20 Mexican poker tables.
And they have like a $1,000 no limit game.
Oh, huge game.
Yeah.
I mean, anybody that remembers Friday night, Jesus. We love Jesus. That's where he plays.
Look at that. Now, Calvin, wow, that is really tight there by Brian if we had the cards up right. Calvin led out with a pair and a flush draw, and Brian just folded the queen-nine flush draw in position in the cutoff. He just folded the queen-ten.
Well, you know, you wonder here now. I mean, obviously, I have no idea, but Brian's got a lot of money now, and so does Calvin. If you wonder if he doesn't want to really get tangled up with the big stack at the table.
That is sometimes why when we saw, like, Jesus and Abel and some of those guys play, hold them. They overvalue one pair in this game. If it's top pair, I mean, they're willing to commit tens of thousands of dollars with it. We've seen it because in Mexican poker, one pair and five-card stud is huge. Top pair is huge.
Well, you think about it. If you have if after three cards,
yeah,
you've got kings or a couple of aces,
yeah,
that's an enormous hand.
Right. That's why I don't think that they necessarily understand the concept in this card, which is a seven-card game, one pair, even if it is top pair, it's not that good. You definitely have to look at your kicker.
Right.
Button moves over here to seat six.
He also wants to know what Padugi is. And Padugi is actually, it's a triple draw game.
Yep.
Where you get, it's four cards. And the best hand, what you're actually looking to do as a Padugi, is all four cards have to be different suits.
Different suits. That
unpaired.
Unpaired, right.
So the best hand you could possibly have, and the lowest is better. So the best hand you could have is actually ace, deuce, 3-4 of different suits.
Basically, you're looking to get four different suits. That is the best hand. And then after that, that is a Padugi hand. And then after that, the Padugis are ranked against each other by the common lowball hand.
Right, exactly.
Which is 1, 2, 3, 4. Whoever's got closest to that wins.
And a Padugi is hard to get. I mean, if you have a jack high, any Padugi is actually pretty good.
And then if nobody has a Padugi, Dave, it's the best three-card Padugi.
Exactly.
And then it's the best two-card Padugi, and so on and so on. So if I have a 1, 2, 3 three-card Padugi, and another guy has a three-card Padugi that's, say, 1, 2, 5, I win.
I've actually noticed, I mean, playing that game, some players don't really understand how to play that. I mean, I'll actually really, when I'm playing that game, if I have ace, deuce, three, and I'm just looking for that fourth card, I'll actually bang my ace, deuce, three. I'll really push it hard.
You're ahead of people if they're drawing.
Of course I am. And the odds are if they're drawing, they're probably not going to catch it. It's hard to catch that card.
Eric raised here out of the small blind of 50 with pocket eights, and he's probably going to take it down here, and he does.
And not only do I bet the ace, deuce, three on all the streets, I'll bet it on the after I got my last draw as well, even as a value bet.
Right.
And sometimes get called by, say, an ace, deuce, five or an ace, three, six.
Straddled pot here by seat number one. And that is a game, Padugi, that is commonly played in high-level mixed games. Yeah. That is a part of their mix. I know that's usually a part of Yosha's mix here in their 300, 600 mixed game. And it is a gambling game.
It can be hard to practice those games because you think about it, you go, you don't really have much experience playing it. Now, fortunately, we played a little bit at 10-20.
Get spread on Doyle's room.
Actually. Does it? Okay.
That's one of their things. Pocket aces here for C5. Limped around three ways in the straddle all the way over to him, and he's probably going to put a nice raise in here.
You'd imagine the first time you play that game, you don't really want to jump in at 300, 600.
Yeah.
60.
He's going to make it 60 here. Now, I've always heard about Padugi, Dave, that it is really more of a gambling game, say, than a deuce to seven triple draw, where you can really make moves, and that's a skillful game because of the cards that you have seen in your draws. You know, if you've discarded three deuces and a couple of sevens in your draws for some reason, or you keep pairing up, or you get, you know, dealt sevens full of deuces, you can really represent a hand because you know,
deuce to seven, because
your opponents can't really make a wheel there. They can't make a really good hand because you really have all the cards in your hand and make a really good hand. Well, I can't imagine Al's going to call. I mean, Al only has about 120 left.
No, he's going to throw it away.
50% of his stack.
Yeah, deuce to seven triple draw. I mean, obviously the two cards that are key, because it's a triple draw game, if you ever play it and you want to know, you need a deuce and a seven in your hand.
Yeah.
Those are the two cards you need. And like you said, obviously, you can almost sandbag. It's almost like playing Omaha 8 if you have four aces.
Right.
And you're playing in a pretty good game.
Yeah.
You know, it's other good players. If you raise, they probably can't call you. Because that means, obviously, they don't have an ace in their hand.
Right. deuce in a seven or deuce to seven triple draw is kind of like an ace in Omaha. I mean, you really shouldn't play any hand without a deuce in it. Now, in Omaha high low, a lot of people will tell you that you can play four cards that work together over nine as a high only hand because the low only comes in about 60% of the time, and that is true.
Yeah, I mean, I obviously have a lot less experience playing Omaha Eater better than you do, but I like a hand. I mean, if you can get, King, Queen, Jack, 10, double suited, I mean, that's a pretty solid hand. Obviously, if you're hitting your hand, there's probably not going to be a low.
Right. We've got a raise here by the cutoff of King, Queen, and Diamonds, and Al's going to call here with sixes. Well, see if he plays a little stop and go. Now, in this case, if a ragged board comes, I would probably move in with sixes here, Dave. Like, right now, I would probably move in
with sixes. Of course. That's a great thought.
And he checked it. And look at this. King, Queen rightly checks right behind him for a free card. Well, the turn's a five. And Al really should bet here. He should have bet the flop.
Yeah, it's a no-brainer.
And he checks again, and King, Queen checks again. And the river's a queen.
Oh, that's terrible.
And this guy really should bet for value here with King, Queen. And he does.
I got to tell you, like the way Albert played this hand here. Never kind of fell for it.
And is he going to get paid off here by Al?
When you really wonder what Al was doing there. You've got sixes. The flop is 10-10-3. I mean, that's the kind of flop you're really looking to hit, isn't it?
Well, if you're going to play it like stop and go, I don't think you can afford to check.
Especially when you get a check behind you. And the turn comes at a five.
Oh, yeah.
You got to know your head there.
Well, see what Al is going to do here.
Well, this tense moment is brought to you by Rod Fleck.
Oh, you got an ace king.
Says, I think you have an ace king, so I'm going to fold my sixes. It's always funny how people. I think I'm holding the best hand. Heads up, Karen.
Right. Okay, great. It's a classic That's Alan moment.
Yeah, yeah.
I know, 100% guarantee I had the best hand. But I'm going to lay it down anyway.
I think we're going to do another chip count here, Dave, and we do.
Yeah, Calvin's still at 1,800. Brian up to 1,600 now. Those two players are really, if they mix it up, we can get a big, big pot. Let's see how they're doing. Shazam. Shazam. There we go. Brian up almost $1,200. Now that's a big, big win in this
game. Yeah, it is.
John up almost 300. Jonathan up 240. And the rest of the table is down. Not surprisingly, consider Brian's up so much.
I need a setup.
Interesting email here from Dave, and I'd love to get to it in a second.
Limped around here six ways. King, 10, 5, rainbow.
Top pair for John is number one.
Yeah. And it gets checked around here. The turn is a queen. It's a second diamond. Eric now has an open-end straight draw and a flush draw on the cutoff.
And can you raise this if you're Eric here? Putting the guy maybe on a queen or a weak king?
I think he might be able to. He makes the call. And he's going to need to hit here to win. The river's a four, and it's no good. And John's going to throw a little kind of a blockish $15 bet
out
there at the end.
Now, it's funny. A lot of those bets in the river like that, I don't know if the players realize what they're doing, but that's what they are.
Yeah.
Clearly a scared bet. Email here from Dave Porcellino says, hey, guys, love the show. How would you suggest you play in this table situation if you're someone with a stack like seat seven? With the size of the opposing stacks so big on this table, how do you approach it? And I guess what he's basically saying is, let's say you were going to sit down in this game bar, and everybody either, a couple of guys have $1,400 or $1,800, somebody else is $1,000, somebody else is $800, and you only can buy in for $200. How might you play it?
Well, I mean, he's talking about Albert's stack size there, and Albert's got about
225.
Well, you're really a short stack here, obviously.
Of course.
You can't be. The funny thing here is, though, is that the big stacks aren't really raising.
No, they're not running this table
over.
They're
not really raising as much as you would think that they would be. So, again, I mean, you can just play poker and realize that you shouldn't be calling raises with small pocket pairs and suited connectors if the raise amount is over $20, really.
Yeah, exactly.
Which
rarely
is pretty much any raise,
I mean, you rarely want to put more than 10% of your money in there. Unless you've got what you think is probably the best hands. And in that case, you could probably be the raiser.
Right. or the re-raiser or the pusher or whatever. Yeah. I think it's just a little frustrating this game is that, you know, it's a really good profitable game once you're deep, but sometimes you just have to sit around and wait to get deep, and sometimes you have to blow through two or three buy-ins to get deep because you have to gamble it up, and it's just like, damn, I wish I could just start with 1,000, right?
Yeah.
Which you can in an uncapped game, so there's no point to having to wait and gamble it up like that.
Well, especially at this game, I mean, with the blinds being relatively high, 2-5, 3-5, I mean, you're talking about you only start with 40 times the big blind.
Right.
You make one raise and one re-raise, and you're pretty much pot committed.
Button's going to move over here to seat two.
That's Reggie. Got to hand it to Reggie tonight. I mean, you saw him earlier on paying some guy off with ace deuce, and he kind of learned from his mistake and got rid of ace nine. Top pair of the bad kicker. He's going to limp in here with king six off suit, though. Not quite sure the value of a hand like that is.
And John does not raise with ace ten of spades on the cutoff. Ace deuce nine here.
20.
Oh, we got a couple of ace tens here. Eric didn't raise either, and he bet right into it.
He bet 20.
John's going to call.
John calls. I got to tell you, that's the minimum that I would call Eric's bet with. Maybe the fact that I have backdoor spades there. And now I pick up a spade draw here on the turn.
And Eric moves all in, and John's going to easily call this, and John is on complete free roll.
And there it is. He makes it. Makes the spades there at the end.
Gotta love it when you're on a free roll. And you know, I don't terribly mind the way Eric played that hand. I mean, I think he looked at it and said, okay, I got called, but if a guy had a hand better than ace 10, might he have raised in the cutoff seat? Probably. If he's, let's say, had ace queen or ace king, he probably raised in the cutoff seat. So I think Eric correctly figured that he had the best hand. In that case, he was actually tied.
Post here by CCW Block saying, Bart, you were going to talk about that $10,000 bill story with Dave, and then you got distracted with the hand. Stop letting that Asian porn distract you. I'll get to it in a second. Actually, Dave was complaining. I was saying that I was reading this thing online about how there will never be a case where there will be any large denomination paper printed over $100 because of money laundering and drug dealing.
Alan's got trip kings.
Yeah. And Calvin is going to come out and bet on the four. Let's see how Al is going to play it in seat four. And Reggie's going to raise with nothing here. Wow, well, that's pretty much going to put Al all in because that's all he has, Dave.
And that'll save Calvin, obviously.
It's funny. If it's an extra $10, can he even call with five
all
or six
in,
here?
91.
I think he can throw it away.
There's no draw there. I mean, would he be calling with the four? Would you think he might have two overs to the four?
I got to tell you, for $5 more, I throw it away. And this is actually almost $30 more. It's an easy laydown.
$30 more into a pot that's about 180, but there's absolutely nothing.
What are you giving me? Give me 25-1 odds. I don't know if I should call this. I could easily be drawing dead.
And he's going to fold.
Right.
So you were whining about how much money you had to bring to the World Series last year to actually pay off.
It's not a matter of whining. It's just a matter of I think our bills are somewhat outdated. $10,000 today is not what it was 25 years
ago.
Right,
but you have to understand that we are probably in the only industry where it would make sense to have larger denominational bills. Now, with electronic banking, wire transfer and such, it's not worth it for them to print a larger bill when 95 to 99% of the use of those bills would be for almost illegal activities, like money laundering, and like drug dealing, and like counterfeiting. There's really not a need for big paper like
that. Obviously.
In England, I think the biggest note is 50 pounds or 50 euros. I don't even know if they have a 100 euro bill. I think they do. But I think in England, I think it's a 50 pound note is the biggest bill.
I don't know.
Yeah. I'm sure I'll find out soon.
Although I'll say a 50-pound note is probably worth about, what, $85?
$80. No, but the point I'm making is that
obviously.
The uses for a larger denomination bill are going to be
most people aren't walking around with $3,000 or $4,000 in cash. They rather have a credit card. I know that.
And there hasn't been a large denominational bill, printed since, I think, it was the 50s. That was the point.
Now, Jonathan has raised this out of the blind with ace-queen, and all the aces are dead. And if anybody's paying attention, Jonathan's played a pretty tight pre-flop. I don't think he can get called. And you imagine not. I can't imagine Calvin calling this, and Jonathan's going to take this down. Now, the only thing, I mean, I was talking about, like, the World Series last year. You saw these guys walking around with, say, you know, $12,000, $13,000 in cash.
Right.
Well, I mean, that's a lot of bills.
Well, it's physically a lot of paper.
Exactly.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely.
I mean, I'm not asking for a $10,000 bill. How about a $500 bill? Like the 50.
Again, I'm telling you, they do not want to print out any bills over $100.
They. Who's they, anyway?
There are too many kickers out there. I'm glad I got you out. Playing for the kickers.
And sometimes unwrap yourself a $100 bill and smell that cocaine, huh? That's, like, supposedly contaminated within about 90 or 95% of all $100 bills in currency.
Really?
Yeah.
I haven't given it a shot. I know what I'm doing tonight. Fun.
It's a funny little thing because apparently bills that haven't been used with, you know, say, people just snort cocaine get, you know, contaminated by other bills that they're touching that have been. So it creates the system.
And it just sits there?
Yeah.
Wow.
King 10 Jack here with a couple of clubs.
Nice flop for Queen Jack, actually. Open ended. Allen's got Queen Jack there. Open ended with second pair. And seat number 9, Allen is going to bet $20. And Al is going to call him with Queen 8. Now, Al is open ended as well. But he's got no pair. So you can see how what good shape Allen's in there. And Jonathan's got 9-10 here. He's not going to play. That's obviously an easy fold. Albert in seat number 7 playing pretty tight. He's going to get rid of it. Eric, who's got queen 8, he's not going to call. And we're going to see this heads up.
Yeah, and I would have laid it down, too.
And the turn is an 8 of clubs. I think even 40. And that's interesting.
Well, it gives Al a pair, but remember, Al is still ahead of queen jack.
Clearly, there's a mistake.
Is there?
Well, look at Al's hands.
Because Al's got queen 7. You're right.
There you go.
Ronnie's finishing up that bottle of
Yeah, well, either way, though, it was a 7 of clubs, actually, in Al's hand. So he did pick up a flush draw, but he missed the open-ended straight draw. He missed the flush draw, and Allen is going to win this with a pair of jacks.
Got a post here on the board here by Pajedo. He says, Bart and Dave, one of my satellites I played at Caesar's Palace had Ron Rose to my left. We talked quite a bit about Live at the Bike. He recalled the hand he had had with Dr. Beebe. I was laughing because I said Ron Rose must be the only player in California to give Dr. Beebe action. He seems to watch Live at the Bike occasionally. He also mentioned that the commentators provide good analysis. Quote, unquote, they know what they're talking about.
Ah. It was funny. I actually saw Ron Rose at Bellagio playing in a 10-20
really?
Olympic game.
Yeah.
I went over to him and I said hi. And we talked for a couple of minutes. He was, I think, stuck. I don't know for sure, but he just wasn't his normal friendly self. I mean, he was friendly, but not overly friendly, and that's not normally like Ron. So I don't think he was running real well. You know, it was one of those, it's nice to see you, but I'm not in a good mood, so leave me alone.
Now, John raised with sixes, and Brian called with ace-jack.
Well, not a good flop for sixes, I got to tell you.
Well, he checks, and I assume that, wow, Brian did not bet there with ace-jack. Well, now Brian has two pair, and now he's going to bet.
Yeah, Brian, I mean, it's funny. Brian's done everything right today, playing a little bit passive there. You wonder why you wouldn't take a shot there with ace-jack. Not much to be scared of. He does have the ace of clubs in his hand as well, so you wonder if he would have called had John bet into him on the turn. Got about 25 minutes left in tonight's show.
I know enough about this game.
If you've missed any part of the show, you can actually watch it. We rebroadcast this show at about 11 p.m. Pacific time, then every 3 hours until
5 p.m. the next day.
Yes.
And all day long on Sundays, starting at noontime.
Exactly.
All times, the real time, the real Greenwich Mean Time, Pacific American time. Bud moves over here to seat number 8. And we got a raise here out of a small blind to 70.
With queen 7.
Yeah, by Allen. Queen 7 off suit. That's
I mean,
you
probably put him on pocket 9s right here, right? Pocket 9s, pocket 10s, or pocket jacks. And he's going to steal about $20.
You know, it is kind of funny, though. I mean, you and I both grew up in East Coast time, Eastern time. And really, America's really based around Eastern time, all the sporting events and it's interesting how you make this transition over here to Pacific time when things start at 9 a.m. and all the, say, major primetime shows are shown out here at the same time, but it is kind of on a three-hour delay. It's on a repeat.
Right. No, it's,
but
it's
everything
clearly
is based
East
around,
Coast bias.
Yeah, based around East Coast time.
I mean, some events, obviously, they try to appease both coasts. You can talk about, like, Monday Night Football.
Right, but
9 p.m.
when they
start.
Do it, when they always talk about, like, World Series events, West Coast against the East Coast team, they really don't want to start the World Series at 9 o'clock Eastern time, which is only 6 o'clock out here.
No,
because
right.
Most of the country isn't going to be able to watch all of it.
No, of course
right?
not.
No? Five-way action here. Limped around.
Ooh.
And John swapped the flush here in seat one.
And not just a flush, though. He's got this open-ended straight flush draw.
He's going to bet right out. He's bet his big hands.
I like this play. Now, Reggie's going to call, and Reggie's actually in really bad shape. Normally, he'd have nine. Normally, you'd have nine outs to your flush draw. But because John has got two of them, he's only at seven outs. And because the 10 and the 5 are no good, he only has five clubs.
Do you even call there? I mean, Reggie's got a pair, but you got two guys behind you. Do you call it the second not club draw there? I mean, you do have a pair, which might increase your chances.
You know, most people just assume that there's no way this guy could be getting a flush. I can call one time with a flush draw. I don't like to call that because there's no implied odds. If I hit my hand, am I really going to get paid?
Remember, Reggie can still catch a straight flush. Well, it turns to seven. John Sand is still good.
Yep. And he's going to build a pot for himself. I really like it.
And
Reggie's not going to call. And the river would have been a deuce. And you wonder if Reggie would have gotten involved if he caught that deuce on the river. Luckily for him, he threw it away.
We'll find out later.
Button moves over to John in seat number one. Small blind is $3. Big blind is $5. And that makes Al under the gun. Al's thinking about it. He's got he's got 8-10. And he's going to limp in. Ace-Jack offsuit in seat number 9 in the cutoff seat. Probably worth a raise. You wonder if he's going to put some money in there. And he is going to raise.
Is he 70 or
60? 60.
And he makes it 60 to go. I mean, these are huge raises. We're talking about the blinds are only 3-5. Now, it's funny, I mean, oftentimes in cash games, you will raise more than, like, let's say the tournaments, you normally raise 3 times or 3.5 times the big blinds. Oftentimes in a cash game, you'll see a raise of more like, say, 5 times or even 6 times the big blind. But in this case, he is actually raising it up. I mean, he's raising it up 12 times the big blind. I just don't see the value of raising that much. You're only going to get called by a hand that can beat you. You're putting in 60 to win yourself, what, 11? You don't have to be a genius to figure out if you do that very long, it won't work. You're going to go broke. And it was a nice surprise for me walking through the Bellagio, actually, in the poker room, and my buddies were playing there, and seeing a lot of people that I either knew or people that had seen the show and recognized me. Nice to know our show is out there. We really do appreciate our fans. Not a real good flop for nines, but he is ahead. And he goes check, check. Turns a four, and that doesn't change anything. And if I'm Al here, I got to put a little bit of money in the pot. I don't want a free card to come off and beat me. And you look at Alan. Alan's going to take a shot at it. He goes, hey, you don't want it. I'll take it.
55.
Doing the old fleck the chip and try to do something look cool.
Didn't know what.
I guess they're trying to debate whether the bet should be 50 or 55. Saying his hands are sticky. A little more information than we need to know, but thank you for sharing. And Al's going to check call this. Well, hey, I guess if you're checking to induce a bluff, go ahead. But how do you know if you're good here? River's a five, and Al is good. And now Al's going to move all in. Man, I just don't understand the value of this play here. Moving all in with nines. I mean, I would have almost liked to bet on the flaw on the turn. But you move in there on the river, if the guy is bluffing, obviously he can't call you. And if the guy has a four or a queen, he probably is going to call you. I mean, I guess you can say, well, maybe there's a little bit of value, you can get a jack off the hand, but I'm not sure if he has enough money to get a jack off the hand. Nice email here from Michael. He says, thanks for the info, Bart. Bart sounds like he knows a lot about drug dealing.
Pocket tens here for Jonathan in seat six.
35.
And he's going to raise it up here to 35. And let's see if Calvin's going to enter here with king, queen. Well, small line's going to call here with looks like either 7-9 of hearts or 8-9 of hearts. 8-9 of hearts. And he still really isn't that deep to make that call out of position. Calvin calls. Oh, he's got trip nines here.
And now, again, is Jonathan going to get involved? Now, you said he was a pretty good player. I'm just curious.
I think he might commit himself here. I mean, he's going to bet. Well, let's see how much he's going to bet here.
Now, I got to tell you, this is the kind of flop that I don't need to bet that much.
Yeah.
There's no draw whatsoever. If a guy doesn't have a nine, they're not going to call pretty much. And sure enough, Al's probably just going to smooth call this. And you get the information you need to know right now.
So you would take a card here on the turn if he calls.
Yeah,
would he call sevens or eights here, though, in this spot?
Well, that's the problem, but you know what?
If he does, he's probably just going to check it to me twice. Right?
Yeah, I don't mind taking the card then, right? And the board's just not real draw heavy. I mean,
turn's an ace.
Now, that is obviously a scary card. Some players will call you. We see Alan all the time calling with, like,
right,
ace-queen.
And he goes check. And the river's a four. And that's going to let probably Jonathan escape, because if Al bets in here, I don't think there's any way that Jonathan can call. Because would Al really bet pocket eights here? I just don't buy it.
No, of course not.
Not at this level.
And there's no draw. He didn't miss something.
And if he bet the flop, he probably would have had all of Jonathan's money. So again, it's probably another $100-$125 mistake by slow playing the nine. I would be really surprised to see Jonathan. Would you call here? I mean, it's obviously easier for us.
Yeah, obviously. You know, like I said, I mean, probably not, but, you know, it's always harder when you're in the table, sitting in that chair. And Al's going to win that hand. Interesting email here from Aaron Duncan. He says, hey, Dave, when I went to Vegas, I just bring traveler's checks. It's as good as cash. They're insured, and you can get them in larger denominations.
That's a pretty good idea, you know.
It's a great idea. Do they take them at a poker table, though?
At the cage? I think they do.
I mean, would they take them at the bike?
You mean actually at the table? You mean like when you went and paid for them at the table, like in a cash game, you mean?
No, I mean, okay, let's say I came here, okay, and I wanted to buy into our Legends main event, which is now $10,000 this year, by the way.
Right.
And I bring a $10,000 in traveler's checks. Will the bike accept traveler's checks?
Well, Alan here is, looks like he is limped in with ace king.
By the way, I'm getting word that they won't take it at the table, they will take it at the cage.
Okay.
But if it's a very large amount of money, the casino is forced to actually fill out a form they send to the government.
Right. Look at that. Look at that. He got limped around. Alan limped, and he thought someone was going to raise, and then Alan put all his money in. So he's actually kind of given away the strength of his hand, the limp re-raise. Oh, I guess someone did raise. It was the button that raised there, Al, with the ace jack. And actually, Alan moved in out of turn before Jonathan had to ask. And
can't wait to get his money in that box.
Easy lay down here for ace jack.
Yeah. Get a nice email from Dave Jones. Euros actually come in 200 and $500 denominations.
Yeah. And that, he only knows that because he's very, very old.
I have one of your
Dave
that's
Jones.
That's actually his
And Al called here with ace jack.
Well,
wow.
He's almost drawing dead here. I mean,
that's unbelievable.
That's about as bad a flop as you can get for ace jack. Against
all
ace
your money with ace jack. That's it, folks.
Yeah, Alan's going to double up here. I mean, you look at that flop there. It's king, seven, deuce. Right? And Alan's got the ace of clubs in his hand just in case it comes runner club. I mean, Al would need running jacks. Man.
And Dave Jones, of course, very, very old, back in the days of no limit five card draw. And that is the website I've checked out there.
Oh, you checked it out.
The federal, Bureau of Engraving website.
Oh, there you go.
At the Treasury Department.
Well, a couple of big hands here. We got Pocket Jackson, seat number one for John, and Eric stuck Queens.
And he's brought in with Queens here to 30.
Okay, now, okay, you're John in seat number one, and a guy like Eric, under the gun, has raised. I'm just smooth calling with Jacks.
And that's what John did, and I think that John, he's smart to do it. A lot of other players at the table would overvalue that and re-raise, but he just calls. Brian comes in with sevens. Al's in there with 9-10. He's going to bring Calvin in here with the speed limit on the button. He's
Brian has had pocket sevens literally.
Four, five,
like
six times.
Yeah, I mean, it's incredible.
It is incredible.
Hasn't had a set with him all night yet. Maybe this will be the time. How about some sort of like fun, like 7-5?
Jack 5-7.
Yeah.
Queen Jack 5. Set over set over set. Come on. Well, top set for Eric. Queen 3-10.
And that's the only set. That's actually probably the worst one for Eric in the sense that, well, he's definitely going to win this.
And he's going to come out and bet.
But he's not going to get any action.
Well, will Al call him with 9-10? Well, Eric's going to bet 100 here.
I'd say the answer is no.
Yeah, that's it.
Grab a can of this one. I just want to see.
No slow play there, huh?
Nope.
Now, let me ask you this. I'm not a big proponent for slow playing. You know that. Our viewers know that. In that case there, I've got top set, and I only $140 deep.
Right, remember, this game really kind of tweaks with what we usually say.
Well, that's what I mean.
It is almost sometimes proper to slow play or manipulate a pot in which you can get your money in and get somebody to call you. And usually the way that you do that when you flop a monster sometimes, especially top set where you know someone doesn't have top pairs, to get somebody to bet so that when you check raise them, they feel forced to call for pot odds.
That's the whole point.
Really game where that happens. You know?
I mean, I got to tell you, when I get a hand like that, I flop top set. The pot's $100. I have top set.
Right.
If I bet, who do you think's going to call
me? Well, it's either, I don't think you bet 100. And again, this is the very, very rare case we say that, but I think that maybe he can bet real weak.
I don't bet at all.
I think he can bet real weak.
It's not like I have to build a pot up. I only have $140.
Right.
I can get that in at any point, right? And my only thought is, you've got to realize, you raised. And nobody re-raised you, so nobody's got aces or kings, right?
Right, and you flop top set.
And you flop top set. What do you think your opponents have
right.
that can call you with?
Now, Reggie is raised here with king-queen, and Al is called with ace-five of spades here.
Yeah, ace-queen? You know, I'm never a proponent for check-raising, especially. But in that case, when I only have $140 left, let somebody take a shot at it. Get some money in the pot.
Ace-jack-four, all hearts. Well, Reggie here has got a straight draw, and he's got the second nut flush draw with king-queen with the queen of hearts. Now, is Al going to get involved here, Dave, with ace-five? Reggie's going to bet right in. He was a pre-flop raiser. Can you really take heat with ace-five of spades on this board?
You shouldn't, but we'll see.
Well, he's all in for 58 here, Dave.
Where did Reggie's money go?
5-8.
You can see that I guess Al is a slight favorite.
I thought Reggie had more money than that.
No, Al's going to get out of there. And so is Alan. Got about, maybe 15 minutes left in the show.
Yeah. What if you had actually running hearts, actually a 10 of hearts on the turn, would have actually given Reggie straight, and then he would have made the flush on the river. Once again, we're live at the bike, folks. I'm David Tuckman here with Bart Hansen. And you are watching No Limit Hold'em. This is a $200 restricted buy-in game. A lot more money than that on the table, though.
You know what just popped into my head, too? And again, I'm sure someone will correct me. You know, Alex, you know who's on the $10 bill?
Yeah.
It's Alexander Hamilton, right? You know he's also on one of the big denomination bills? Remember, there's only hundreds, thousands, five thousands, and ten thousands. I think he's on, like, one of the versions of either the five or the $10,000.
Really?
Interesting. Interesting stuff here.
Yeah.
Live at the button.
The stuff you learn here.
And a couple of those larger currency bills are only issued for like 2 weeks, and then they're pulled.
And look at this raise here. It was limped around, and Alan made it $15 more at 8-9.
Yeah.
Flop comes out king high, and Reggie and Calvin have the same hand. Both have king 10. And Alan raises out of the blind, but decides not to continue. And Reggie's going to bet his king. And Calvin's going to call. Actually, wow, Calvin's raising this up.
40 more.
He's going to make it 40 more here.
Makes it 40 more. And if you're Calvin here, I mean, if you're Reggie here, what can you beat? Wow, and Rich is going to throw away the king there.
Show that card. I'll show you that one, too.
Well, it's real tough to continue on there with King 10. You
no, it definitely is.
Board. And the button is going to move over here to C8.
I'll tell you, the World Series of Poker circuit events are really actually getting very bad turnouts. They were talking about a $10,000 event getting only about 120 people.
Well, was that directly opposite to the exact $10,000 event in the WPT?
I had this conversation.
Well, they're not televised anymore, though, the circuit events, so there's
no
reason.
It's not just that. I had a conversation with somebody. I just don't understand. I'm so anti-Harris right now. I'm beside myself. It almost seemed like there was a level of respect among the casinos with poker tournaments where nobody else stepped on somebody else's shoes.
Right, right. They would not schedule it, yeah.
Like the Bike had their tournaments, and then this casino would have their tournaments, and then Bellagio would have this tournament, and then the World Series would be during this month, and so forth. But Harris kind of went and said, you know what, we're going to do whatever we want when we want to do it. And if you don't like it, tough shit.
Four-way action here. 6-4-3, middle set for Calvin. Doesn't look like anyone really has much there. And it gets checked around, Dave. And, well, the turn's a 9. Alan picks up. I mean, you check a set like that on a board, not necessarily because you think you're going to beat, but what happens if a deuce, a 7, a club comes? Will you get any more money in the pot?
I think you're overlooking it. I mean, I think there's only really... There are no scary cards out there. I mean, look at that. I don't know, of course.
Now we get, you know, he looks like a genius because now Alan comes and bets 7-9, and Calvin's going to raise it up to 140.
I got to tell you, if I have a set of fours on that flop, I am betting it 98% of the time.
Yeah. You're probably betting a pot size bet, right? Not some chintzy bet.
I mean, it depends on obviously how much money I have left, how much money my opponents have left, and so forth, who my opponents are. But yeah, I'm not slow playing that hand. And Alan, you got to think about it here. What can you beat?
I always just thought it was interesting. I thought maybe the World Series, the circuit event, the $10,000 event, was directly opposite the day of the $10,000 WPT event.
There was actually no. I mean, there was actually on Saturday.
And he makes the call.
Oh, my. Wow. And he's in terrible shape.
He's got a straight draw to the 5 here, and that's all it's going to help him. And the river's a 3, and Calvin fills up.
Yeah.
And look at this. Now he bets the rest of it. And obviously, Calvin is going to, again, look like a genius with the way that he played that. But which will, again, develop bad habits.
Of course.
Yeah.
Of course. You'll see that same player now take his $2,100 and go to the 5-10 game and do that again.
Right.
And then wonder how he loses the pot or wonder how he doesn't get paid off by, say, pocket aces.
Yeah.
Yeah, there was actually an event on Saturday. How's this? The World Poker Tour event at Mirage. They had it was a $1,500 no-limit event. Starting at the same exact time, there was a $2,000 event over at the World, over at Caesars.
Right.
In the same city.
Right.
Nonetheless. I mean, you gotta, it just makes you wonder and scratch your head.
Huh. You know, what would have been funny is that the circuit event was like in, you know, butt-fuck wherever. Georgia,
yeah.
Alabama, someplace like that. Well, opposite to a tournament that was in Vegas, how the turnout would have been there. You know?
See, I actually have no problem. If they want to do like an East Coast, West Coast thing,
right,
where there's maybe the World Series of Poker Circuit is going on in Atlantic City,
right.
While there's a World Poker Tour event going on in Las Vegas, okay.
Right.
But in the same city, I mean...
40. Seat 6 is going to raise her to 40. Pocket 7s. He's going to take it down.
I was actually talking.
Sorry about that, Ronnie. Bumfuck.
I wasn't going to say anything. I was going to let it slide. But anyway, I was actually talking to somebody who actually thinks that the World Series of Poker Circuit events will probably die out within the next couple of years.
Well, now that, like I said, the preliminary World Series of Poker events aren't going to be televised. The circuit events started so that they could get another 5 events televised before they started televising the preliminary World Series of Poker events. Now the preliminary events aren't even televised.
Albert here with Ace Jack suited, and he's going to raise it up. He's going to make it looks like $35 to go. And look at this.
Wow.
Al is going to call him heads up. out of position with deuce three of spades.
With about $200, he calls $30 here.
And if spades comes out, he's dead. Well,
this is both players here. 9-7.
He's going to check. You imagine Albert's. Wow, Albert does not bet that.
And now he takes. Remember what happened last time with the king queen, remember? And he checked it again. And the river's a king. He didn't bet with the ace jack.
And Al just never takes a shot at it. And Albert just checks it down.
Yeah.
He's content in just taking it down.
Surprised he didn't bet the turn there.
Yeah.
Well, you know, there's always this thing about how poker ratings are down. WPT is down to 2003 ratings. ESPN, World Series of Poker, is down to, you know, ratings that were back in 2000.
But that's ridiculous when you look at that, because they talk about ratings, though, and you go, back when the World Poker Tour first started out, their ratings were growing, you know, exponentially, because they were the only poker show out there.
Right.
Now you've got, you know, between that, you've got Poker Superstars, you've got World Series on ESPN, you've got Live at the Bike. There's a lot of competition out there. I mean, it's the same adage they look at, like, ABC has been wondering for years why Monday Night Football ratings are going down. You know, when Monday Night Football...
Further segmented audience.
Yeah, exactly.
3,000 channels. King 3-4 here, a couple spades. Queen 10 of spades over there in seat number 6. And Jonathan is going to bet with the spades. He bets 15. Nobody has a king here. He's probably going to take it down right now. You know, I got to make a calling out to the Card Player Awards. I think they need to set up a category. I don't necessarily even know if they had Best Poker Show as one of their awards for next year during the Card Player Awards, but I think they need to have Best Commentators as a separate kind of category.
What happens to that Bluff one?
Yeah, what happened to the Bluff? I don't think it's published yet. Still ongoing, that poll. You can vote for Barton.
Wow, okay. Yeah. Left-hand side of our website, you go to liveatthebike.com. Bluff Magazine has kind of a poll where you can vote for your favorite card room, favorite internet site, favorite poker show, favorite commentators. And if you're so inclined and you do like what we do, we appreciate it. You can go to liveatthebike.com, click on the left-hand side that says vote for Bart and Dave, and that'll take you to the polls.
I'd like to get dressed up, you know, go to the Card Player Awards at the Henry Fonda Theater next year. Best commentating.
Hey, I'm all for it.
I'll dress in a nice corset. We'll debutante our way through the red carpet, Dave. Five-way action here.
Top pair for Calvin. Not much of a kicker, but he's got the best hands. And it checks around. One of the reasons why Jack 3 out of position like that, not really a hand you want to play.
20.
No, he's going to bet 20.
Generally speaking, you're going to win a small pot or lose a big one. And look, Jonathan calls this. What does Jonathan have?
He's got second pair. And now an overcall by Reggie because he's picked up a hard draw. Now, that's a case where Reggie really probably could have raised there with a bet and a call in between.
Definitely.
And the river is a heart, and he makes it.
Yeah, running hearts. And that's the problem with a hand like Jack 3. You're in the lead to the flop. You're in the lead on the turn, but you just have no idea where you're at.
That's a call by Jack 3 and an overcall by Jonathan with King 6.
Well, that's sick.
I'm a little surprised there by
that
Jonathan.
That is sick. And Reggie takes it down with the running hearts.
Yeah. Actually, you know what? I don't think Reggie had enough money there. Well, he probably didn't have enough money. Yeah, he didn't have enough money to make a move. He was going to get called. But he didn't have enough money to call the dry flush draw on the turn.
Right.
I mean, although he does get paid off in two spots on the river.
Yeah. I can understand. You know, you understand Calvin calling it. But then, obviously, Jonathan asked that. You wonder.
Yeah.
Kind of makes you scratch your head.
A lot of Broadway out here. Ace Queen, two Ace Queens, Ace Jack, and King Queen. Seat number 5, 6, 7, and 8 all have Broadway.
I like seat number 1's hands. 10, 8 suited.
Right. And Calvin's going to make it 40 here. And this is another case, I mean, seat number 1 there, and that is John, he's got about 500. I don't even know if you call here. Well, it's an additional 35. He's out of position. Now that
I guess
I think you do call. But you definitely wouldn't call that heads up, and maybe not even
Not out of position. I don't want to call that heads up. Once again, there's no guarantee that Calvin's got a big pocket pair that he's going to pay you off. Flop's got to come out something sort of like queen, jack, 9 for me to really make any money. And even then, Calvin might get away from it. I mean, maybe the flop comes out ace, 10, 8. But once again, how much money am I really going to make? You guys only got top pair.
Six-way action here. And Al's in there with 4-5. Oh, Jack 8-4 with a couple of diamonds, and Jonathan outflops them all. Is he going to bet out here, or is he going to try to check raise?
I gotta tell you, it's somewhat of a scary board. If they take a free card, you got to be wary that their players could have diamonds. Somebody could have 9-10. Somebody could have even king 10 with a gut shot.
It's a $240 pot. If I'm going to call that flop, I might move in right away there if I'm Jonathan with 225.
Yeah, you might.
I mean, is that a way to play it? I mean, the only problem is Calvin going to fire in here to five players?
I mean, let me ask you this, though. If you bet ace jack, they're all in.
I check two.
Gets checked around.
Is there any way you get called by a better hand?
Well, now he's turned three jacks. And now he's going to come out and bet.
And now does John in seat number one think he's good?
75.
He's going to bet 75. Kind of a weakish bet. From what I've seen, John, I'd be kind of surprised if he's going to actually get involved here.
No, he doesn't get involved. No.
But how about Al with 4-5, Dave? He's struggling over there.
Yeah, and obviously we can see by the check mark, Jonathan cannot lose his hand unless he throws it away. What does Calvin do?
I don't know, Dave. Something kind of scary.
Two pair.
And Jonathan takes it down.
We're going to get into the last hand of the night here. It's been kind of a fun night here tonight. A little $200 game. Again, tomorrow night we're going to be doing a special $200 no limit hold'em game. And then we'll be back on Wednesday hopefully for the 25-50 whale game, Dave. The butt moves over here to seat six.
A couple of limpers.
Four-way action.
If that happens, I'll give you $5.
$20 to the flop.
Queen Jack 3 here with a couple of diamonds. I think we got a Queen 9 there for Eric.
Yeah, I think Eric's going to put a little money in here, see where he's at.
He is.
Pot size bet. Reggie's got nothing.
Doesn't look like anyone else really has anything here.
Now this could do it.
And that is going to do it for us tonight. Another episode of Live at the Bike down in the Live Annals. Headed over to the archives there. for everybody here in the booth and for Dave Tuckman, it's been a fun night, Dave. Huh?
Yeah.
It has been. Again, we'll be back here tomorrow for 200-35 no limit. So good night, everybody, from Live at the Bike.
It's here. It's big. And it's closer than you think. It's not a tournament. It's what you don't see on TV. The cash is real. The stakes are high. They bet big. They win big. They lose big. High stakes live action poker. Live at the Bike. Watch it live on the web or play it if you dare at the Bicycle Casino right here in Los Angeles.